Good morning. I'm Ken Weinstein, President and CEO of Hudson Institute. I'd like to welcome our audience here at the Walter and Betsy Stern Conference Center, our audience on C-SPAN's Book TV, those of our panelists who have already arrived, and those who will be arriving in a couple of minutes. Let me simply note that Hudson Institute is an international policy research organization based on the proposition that security, prosperity, and the defense of global order requires strategic and engaged U.S. international leadership in partnership with our allies. We're delighted to be hosting today's event with the Center for Immigration Reform and Encounter Books on the occasion of the publication of a new Encounter broadside on the debate over immigration, which Roger Kimball will introduce shortly. There is, of course, not much of a debate over President Obama's recent executive order over immigration, which an overwhelming majority of both liberal and conservative constitutional scholars view as unconstitutional, but there is a significant debate in the country over immigration, different positions that are held deeply passionately and reflect, frankly, differences, tensions in America's founding principles. And we will hear this morning from noted conservatives whose views strongly differ on the subject. Let me say a few words about Encounter Books before we get underway. Encounter Books, whom we're delighted to partner with, stands athwart trends in the publishing world by publishing serious books on critical policy and cultural questions under the leadership of Roger Kimball, who is its publisher and president. Roger is, of course, well-known as well as the editor and publisher of The New Criterion, the wonderful New York Journal of Culture and Arts founded by the late Hilton Kramer, the former New York Times arts editor. Roger's books and articles have appeared in every publication of consequence in the English language. Roger is known for his Tory sensibilities, for his willingness to challenge the vacuousness of the avant-garde in the name of the Western tradition, and for his dedication to sensible and open debate on critical questions. So it's with that, let me, with great pleasure, turn it over to Roger.
Thank you, Ken. Your frankness does you credit. It's I'm delighted to be here to welcome you all, and we will soon be welcoming two more panelists who are been delayed in traffic, I guess. This is a critical debate. We will be handing out, when you leave, copies of this important broadside that Encounter Books has published. Open borders, yay and nay. So you will get a copy of this upon leaving. I'm not going to introduce the panelists. It would be superfluous. I just wanted to point out that it is not true, as some people have suggested, that we hired Barack Obama to be an advance publicity person for this conference. That is not true. He did it on his own initiative. But we're delighted that he was able to bring such focus to this important issue. I think it's an important debate, and there are no easy answers, I think. Alex Naraste will start things off with a kind of précis of his broadside, and then Mark Krikorian will follow. We'll have the other panelists will comment on it. Then we'll allow Alex and Mark to respond, and then we'll open it up to the audience. So perhaps you'll have something you'd like to say as well, Alex.
Thank you very much for that introduction. Thank you to Hudson for putting together this great event, for Encounter, for publishing the book, for the Center for Immigration Studies for co-sponsoring it, and for all of you being here today. I believe that American and classically liberal notions of liberty demand a presumption in favor of the right to voluntarily migrate across borders. I believe the burden is upon those who oppose such a right to show why it should be restricted, just as we would demand very good reasons to support taking away the individual rights of life, liberty, or prior property in other situations. Right now, it is illegal for all but a small number of people who want to come here lawfully into the United States. The tradition of relatively free immigration that we had in America's past was closed a long time ago. and replaced by a very highly complicated bureaucratic system, centrally managed to select certain types of people based on political prerogatives rather than on other issues. As the law is written, the burden is on the immigrant to prove that he should be able to immigrate, which I think is entirely backwards from our Western notions of, or an American notions of guilty until, innocent until proven otherwise. I believe the burden should be on the government to demonstrate why an individual immigrant should not be able to come, and the reason should be pretty good. The current system is the equivalent of presuming every immigrant is guilty and forcing them to prove their innocence, a view that our ethics and traditions, I think, rightly abhor. So I'm going to go through three basic reasons why I think the United States should have a much more open immigration policy than it currently does. One, the consequences of immigration to the United States is positive, especially from the economic perspective. Two, ethical reasons. I think our ethical, our Western traditions of ethics support this from every single perspective. And three, our principles of individual liberty, American traditions, and Western civilization. I'm just going to sort of tie the ethics and principles part together as we go because it's very difficult to separate them. So consequences, economics. There is a lot of popular disagreement over the net effect of immigration on the U.S. economy, but there is very little disagreement amongst economists. Broadly, economists agree on basically three big things. One, price controls are bad. Two, free trade is good. And three, immigration is good for the economy. The disagreement over is exactly how good is it and exactly whom is it best for. That's the big disagreement. And this is economists on the right side of the spectrum and on the left side of the spectrum. We talk about this. Now, if you think about it, the number one issue that people think about when they think about immigration and the economy is the impact on American wages. So if you all remember your very simple sort of supply and demand model, you know, a big increase in supply of workers should lower wages, right? That's sort of your number one understanding of the basics of economics. If I were to increase the number of apples by quite a bit in the economy, we would expect the number of apples to fall, the price of apples to fall. But something different happens with labor, because apples don't buy other apples. They don't buy the services of other apples. But immigrants, who are people, buy the services of other people in the economy, increase in demand for labor. Most economic studies find that the wage effects of immigration on Americans are very small. A lot of them actually find that it is positive as well. Now, why is that? It's because the economy is dynamic. It's not that the economy is not static. If we were to increase the supply of anything in a static economy and nothing else changes, then we would expect the price of that to fall. But the rest of the economy adjusts. What we see over time is the amount of capital investment increases due to population over time. Most immigrants and most Americans have different skills, so they're not directly competing with each other. So there's very little competition. Because of that, we have complementarities, which economists sort of differentiate from being substitutes. If you're substitutes with somebody, that means you compete in the labor market. More of you would likely lower the wage. But if you're complements in the labor market, that means that you have different skills that can work together and increase demand for both of your jobs. I think one of the best examples of this is low-skilled immigration in the restaurant industry. What we see is low-skilled immigrants who on paper have similar skills to low-skilled Americans specialize in jobs that require brawn or physical labor over communication skills. Because one of the big advantages of being an American is being able to speak English, because, you know, Americans don't learn other languages. I don't learn another language. I have no intention of ever doing so. And you know, I lived in Europe. Everybody speaks like seven languages. Fortunately, they all speak English, which is the only language I speak too. What you see is this division of labor occur, where low-skilled immigrants work in professions that require brawn and manual labor, and low-skilled Americans get bumped up into professions that require communication skills. So in a restaurant, what jobs do lower-skilled immigrants work in? They are the busboys, the dishwashers, jobs that don't require much communication with customers who speak English. What jobs do lower-skilled Americans do in restaurants? They're the waiter, the waitress, the hostess, jobs that require communication that are more highly compensated. And of course, the number one issue is demand. Immigrants buy things. They buy goods and services from other people. And people produce these other goods and services. So immigrants increase the demand for labor in the US economy. Now, one of the most interesting things is that wages are determined by productivity of the worker in the US economy, how much productivity they add to the firm as they go forward. So let's say a worker produces $20 of value for his firm. That is the maximum wage that he could possibly be paid, is $20, because he produces that amount. Now, what's interesting is this basic notion in economics: if wages were to increase because of a decrease in the supply of labor, that means that the price of the products they produce must go up. So that is the actual result of it. So if you're claiming that a decrease in the supply of workers will increase the wages, that's going to be offset by large part by an increase in the price of the goods that they build. And as we all know, the source of wealth in the economy is not necessarily the dollar amount on your paycheck or on your bank account, but what you can actually buy with those goods and services. Now, immigration is a voluntary, mutually beneficial wealth-creating exchange. The costs of immigration are not fully internalized to all of the people who were involved in that transaction, but neither are all the benefits internalized to all the people in that transaction. If we have such a standard that immigration should only be allowed so that all the costs and benefits are internalized to the people that are involved in this transaction, then that would basically wipe out any other sort of economic transaction that's going on. Furthermore, our presumption, I think, in favor of free markets shows us that we should favor a relatively free labor migration. Labor compensation is equal to about 62% of GDP in the United States. It's the largest portion of GDP. If we like free markets, if we like free trade, if we like competition, we should be willing to open up this part of the United States to more competition and more free trade, especially in this important area. If you think that the increases in the supply of labor are going to drastically decrease the wages of people in the United States, I want you just to ask yourself a question. Why are wages so much lower in the middle of Wyoming where there are very few people, and so much higher in places like Manhattan where there are so many more people? There is a lot more things going on there. Now, what about welfare? I work at the Cato Institute. I'm very concerned about the welfare state and the size of it. But all of the arguments here against immigration because of welfare are really arguments against the existence of the welfare state to begin with. It's a much better argument to go on and say we should build a wall around the welfare state rather than chopping off immigration because there exists a welfare state. You can make a similar argument that there should be mandatory dietary restrictions because government has socialized parts of the healthcare industry in the United States. Now, I think as free marketeers, libertarians, and conservatives, we would accept that argument as ludicrous. The problem is the socialized medicine in the system, not necessarily the fact that we eat too much. So I don't think one bad government regulation in one area, like the welfare state, justifies another government intervention into the market economy in another area, whether it's dietary restrictions or the free movement of people. What's more is poor immigrants are less likely to consume welfare than poor Americans are, and when they do so, the dollar value is smaller. If poor Americans consumed Medicaid at the same rate that poor immigrants do, and the dollar value was the same, the program would be 42% smaller. In terms of the entitlement programs, as it currently stands, immigrants tend to subsidize these massively overblown and bankrupt programs. There's really nothing we can do to save these programs right now as they exist, like Medicare and Social Security. They're going bankrupt as they stand, but immigrants do increase the positive cash flow. So hopefully, if and when Congress decides to fix these programs, it'll be a little bit easier to do. There have been hundreds of studies about the fiscal impact of immigration. How does it affect taxpayers in the United States? And I wish I could give a more interesting answer to that, but all the effects tend to be clustered around zero. Turns out that immigrants and their descendants almost entirely, mostly pay for the government services that they consume. These are dynamic models done across the world and about the United States. Now, what about the political externalities? Will immigrants flood into the country, vote for radical left-wing parties, destroy capitalism, destroy our institutions, overrun these things? As far as we can see, we don't find that effect either in the United States or internationally. What's interesting to point out is if you take a look at the per capita expenditures of the federal government in the United States, by far the period of time when there was the most rapid increase was between 1930 and 1970, when it was virtually impossible to immigrate to this country lawfully unless you were from Northern Europe. The federal government expenditures per capita increased 17-fold during that time period. In the period of time since 1970, when immigration has been liberalized, you've seen a doubling in per capita expenditures per person, but you've also seen an increase in immigration. Prior to 1930, in the 30 years from 1900 to 1930, you also saw a doubling, but interestingly enough, the period of time when immigration was closed off is when you saw the largest increase in the size of the federal government. Now, I'm not claiming that immigration is the reason why federal government growth slowed post the opening of the border, but I'm saying if you're going to make the claim that immigrants are going to increase the size of the government, you have a lot of historical explaining to do. In fact, Vernon Briggs Jr., who is, I believe, an adjunct scholar at the Center for Immigration Studies and a labor economist, supports broadly immigration restrictions because it makes possible these broad increases in federal government and broad increases in the social safety net. Now, what do we do when we take a look at the economic freedom score across the world and the United States? It's true, of course, that economic freedom creates more prosperity in countries, and more prosperity attracts immigrants. So what we tried to do with our research paper is to see if there's any effect of immigrants, say, in 1970, and how it affects economic freedom in every decade after that, or period of years after that, in each country around the world, to see if there's some kind of effect, to see if there's a slowing in liberalization of economies around the world. And we actually find a positive effect. We find a positive effect that stocks of immigrants over time are correlated with increases in economic freedom over time as well, even on the national level in the United States. We find different results on the state level in the United States, but still, if you're going to make the claim that immigration is going to destroy free markets or force people or move the political spectrum against free markets, you still have a lot of explaining to do because the correlation does not support that explanation. Take a look at size of means-tested welfare benefits over time in the United States across states. Fortunately, states have very different sizes of the immigrant population, very different demographics that have been influenced by immigration, and a lot of control over a lot of their means-tested welfare benefits. What we find is that there is no correlation from 1970 to 2010 between the size, the intensity of flows of immigrants, the size of the minority populations that have been increased because of immigration, on the size of means-tested welfare benefits. We see no impact over time. We could also tell a similar story about guns, or support for banning handguns in the United States based on Gallup poll. Support for banning handguns, and this is important to me as a gun hobbyist and enthusiast, there's an argument out there that immigrants are very opposed to guns and their descendants will be as well, and they'll vote for gun restrictions. Interestingly enough, support for banning handguns peaked in the 1950s at a period of time when lawful immigration to the United States was at its lowest ebb, and now we've seen a decrease in support for banning handguns down to the low to mid 20s%, as the percentage of the population that's foreign-born has also increased. So I'm not saying that immigration has caused these popular opinions or these effects that I'm describing, just that if you're going to claim the opposite, you have a lot of explaining to do because the data does not support you. So what about ethical arguments? What about the arguments from our traditions about what is right and wrong and how to treat people? Where does that impact our perspective on immigration and what immigration policy should be? I think we need to apply the same ethical standards to immigrants that we apply to other people, and that people have equal moral worth. Now, of course, we favor certain people over others. I favor my wife, for instance. I will do more to help her. I have more of an obligation to help her than I have to help any of the rest of you. You're all fine people. But that's the moral obligation. I have an obligation to help my family and probably an obligation to help people who are other Americans more than I do other people. There is certainly a hierarchy of these obligations. But just because I have an obligation to help somebody doesn't mean that I can do everything possible to help them. What matters is how I can help them. So if my wife is applying for a job, I can help her write her resume. I can proofread her letter of introduction. I can do research. I can help her pay for education to get her better skills. What I cannot do is tie the other job applicants who are competing for that job to a tree to prevent them from also applying for the same job. I can't block other people using coercion to do that, and I think we need to apply the same standards to immigrants. Now, they're just isn't much competition between Americans and immigrants in the job market because the skills are different. But I think even if there was a lot of competition between immigrants and Americans, such intense competition that it lowered American wages, that is still not an argument to oppose immigration, primarily because of our English common law traditions. Another immigrant import, by the way. Economic harms that arise through market competition or through competition are not a sufficient reason for protectionism. If I am a baker on one street and you open up a bakery down the other street and you put me out of business because you sell a better loaf of bread, I can't sue you. It's called Damnum Absque Injuria. I do not, because I participate in the market economy, I took those risks. In terms of the same thing goes for immigration. Freedom of contract in our system, even with immigrants, I think is more important than supporting notions of economic protectionism that build big barriers of big government to protect certain people from protectionism, from competition with other immigrants. Now, what about our natural rights tradition? Individual rights to life, liberty, and private property precede the creation of the state in the Enlightenment, classically liberal tradition of the word. And Locke and all these different writers, these rights precede the creation of the state, and people have equal ethical and moral worth. The Declaration of Independence listed restrictions on immigration and naturalization as one of the many reasons for seeking their independence. The classical notion of laissez-faire, which you've all heard, has to do with free market economy. It's an old French phrase. Was patterned and timed with and often phrased with the other phrase, laissez-passer, which means let them pass. Let people pass and move to economic institutions to have the jobs of freedom. You know, freedom to move is a prerequisite for a lot of the other freedoms that we enjoy, as well as a freedom in and of itself. Now, immigration restrictions are human-created laws that have no basis in human rights. No basis in natural rights. You cannot find a justification in natural rights theory, which is the foundation for our system of government in terms of the ideology that supports immigration restrictions for any of these reasons. Now, what about utilitarianism? Another proud Western philosophical tradition, the economic argument above. Voluntary, mutually beneficial exchanges in a relative free market are wealth-producing and should be allowed. They produce more wealth than they destroy in other areas. In the same way that capitalism in other areas are good. Now, under each of these ethical systems, under each of these ways of judging it, all Western in their origin and traditions, borders are ethically irrelevant. They matter for other reasons, but in terms of this, they are ethically irrelevant. What about the rule of law? An important argument. We supposedly can't legalize large numbers of unlawful immigrants or change our immigration laws substantially because that would violate the rule of law. Now, I think the rule of law is an important tradition in the United States. It's one that has helped us prosper in the United States, but laws must be based on an accurate accounting of human nature and respect for human liberty. They cannot be based on the whims of legislators or social engineers who have decided that the US population must be based on some sort of arbitrary standard of who we accept, like immigration restrictions are. Rule of law does not mean that all laws are enforced or enforced equally. We can think of lots of laws in American history that were heinous, that we're pretty glad weren't enforced to the full hilt, as well as lots of other countries. The main three portions of the rule of law are that they should generally be applied equally, they should be ex ante, relatively predictable outcomes, and consistent with our traditions. All three of those are required. Immigration laws fail on each and every one of those. They are inconsistent with our traditions of welcoming immigration to the United States. From 1790 to 1875, we had open borders in this country, and only gradually after that point were more and more restrictions placed on until the 1920s, when it was almost totally closed off to the rest of the world. Equally applied, they're certainly not equally applied laws. They treat people differently based on skills, country of origin, family, status, things that would be unacceptable in other areas of the law. And they're certainly not ex ante predictable. You can talk to any people who have the same characteristics, they apply for the same immigrant visa, and you have radically different outcomes. If you want people to respect our immigration laws, and I believe the laws must be respectable, and I currently think the mess that they are is not respectable. William F. Buckley Jr. said that laws attempting to stop unauthorized immigration were in the same category as King Canute standing on the beach and ordering the tide not to come in. I think it shows a fundamental misunderstanding of reality, how the world works, to think that you can minutely control and stop all immigration, or at least the vast majority of it. Whenever there is a disconnect between law and reality, reality always finds a way of making the law irrelevant. Now, in conclusion, I will state that relatively free immigration or open immigration is the exact opposite of a big government policy. Because it would mean removing some of the most economically destructive laws that are currently on the books today. If free trade results in more Japanese cars being imported, we don't say that the government forced Japanese cars into the US through a big government program. We say that the market allowed Americans to import cars from Japan. If we were to radically liberalize American immigration laws, then the same thing would take effect. It would allow more immigrants to come here lawfully, to be employed by Americans, and to engage in voluntary market interactions. The total value and net present value, the present value of all American human capital, of the skills, of the productivity, of other values of American productivity, is worth about $750 trillion. That's compared to about the value of all of our physical factories, plants, computers that produce things, which is only about $45 trillion. If we believe in free markets, if we believe that free trade and free exchange and capitalism are the right economic systems, we should definitely expose this rather large part of the U.S. economy that is currently protected to international competition and cooperation. There are massive economic gains to liberalizing immigration. It's consistent with American traditions. It's consistent with our exceptional ability to assimilate people over time, which has not changed, by the way, according to all the measures done by Jacob Vigdor, who has measured this. And everyone around, so free movement. So in conclusion, basically on all the Western ethical principles that I have talked about, on the traditions of American liberty and our traditions of freer immigration in the past, support for the rule of law, and for the positive economic benefits, I think that the United States should support a rather open immigration policy that allows peaceful and healthy people from around the world to come here and work and hopefully eventually naturalize and become Americans. So thank you very much, and I look forward to what everyone else has to say.
Everything Alex said was wrong. So I'll now spend the next 25 minutes telling you why. The first question of immigration policy is whether the American people have a right to limit immigration. Alex argues no, frankly making the whole rest of the presentation kind of irrelevant. If freedom of movement into someone else's country is a natural right, as Alex claims, then it doesn't really matter what the economic or fiscal or political consequences are. It is a moral question, not a contingent empirical question. This first question is one of values and can be answered really in only one of two ways. Either we, the people of the United States, in order to form a more perfect union, establish justice, and so on, have the exclusive right to decide who moves into our national home and who does not, or foreigners have the exclusive right to decide for themselves whether they want to move to the United States or not, and we don't get a vote. If the American people have a right to self-determination, a right to decide who is permitted to enter our national territory and who is not, then debate is possible over the practical effects of one set of policies or another. Now, this doesn't imply any specific policy, but that is the starting point of a debate over policies. If, on the other hand, the American people, as Alex has claimed, is morally prohibited from limiting immigration into the United States, then debate is irrelevant. Essentially, it's a question of choosing which moral value matters to you. Alex claims that there is a natural right to free movement, and I disagree. I hold that the American people have the right, through laws duly enacted by their elected representatives, to set the terms of admission into their national home. In other words, immigration is a privilege that we grant to people, not a right that people are able to claim against us. This entails no policy in particular. From that starting point, you could argue for high immigration or low immigration. You could argue for an emphasis on skills or an emphasis on family relationships or something else. You could argue for a more simplified, streamlined system of managing immigration or a very complicated and bureaucratic one. But it is we collectively as a people, through the arrangements we have established in our Constitution, who get to decide who comes here and who does not, not the outsiders. Given that, what should we do? In my half of the booklet, I offer a kind of unified field theory of immigration policy based on the premise that mass immigration is incompatible with the goals and characteristics of a modern society. These are broadly shared goals in modern America that even though people with different political opinions will differ as to the means, the ends themselves are not disputed by mainstream people. For instance, physical security, a strong sense of shared national identity, a middle-class society, a responsible system of social provision for the poor. Mass immigration undermines all of these goals. Now, this is a change from the past, and the change is not the change in the immigrants. Today's immigrants really aren't all that different from immigrants of the past. They're from different countries, but ultimately they're the same kinds of people coming from the same parts of their own society. What's different is what they meet when they come to the United States. Immigration a century ago was still a very, even then, was a tumultuous and unsettling process, something that we tend to forget in our sentimental recollections of the past. But under the social and economic conditions of the past, we were able to make it work and make it quite successful. It was an important tool of nation building. It wasn't the only one. We're not just a nation of immigrants, but we are, among other things, a nation of immigrants. But that's no longer the case, and it's time to move on. To borrow from St. Paul, who wrote to the Christians in Corinth, "When I was a child, I spake as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things." Mass immigration is one of those childish things that a grown-up America has to put aside. Now, let me touch briefly on the more important areas of conflict between mass immigration and modern society, and then briefly sketch how we might get there from here. First, assimilation. This is probably the most important factor in immigration, and that is to say, successfully making the newcomers and their posterity into patriotic Americans, identifying with the American people as their people, and the American past as their past, adopting, in a sense, America's past as their own, even if it wasn't that of their biological ancestors. And a different scriptural quote is relevant here in describing what real assimilation looks like. When the foreigner Ruth says to her mother-in-law, her Israelite mother-in-law, Naomi, "Whither thou goest, I will go, and where thou lodgest, I will lodge. Thy people shall be my people, and thy God my God. Where thou diest will I die, and there will I be buried." That's assimilation. And that has to be the chief consideration in among the chief considerations in making immigration policy. And two changes in us, not in the immigrants, matter here and make assimilation much more complicated problem, a much more lengthy phenomenon, much less complete in its workings. And that is, one, the revolution in transportation and communications technology that has shrunk the world, and two, the elite's loss of commitment to the goal of patriotic assimilation and Americanization. Just briefly, the technological changes are obvious to everybody. Communications is, frankly, it's free at this point with Skype to call anywhere in the world. Transportation is, travel is dramatically less expensive than it was in the past. And what this does, I mean, this obviously has many positive influences. I mean, positive effects. I'm all for it. But in the immigration context, it eliminates the need, the pressure forcing immigrants to reorient their emotional and psychological attachments from the old country to the new country. This is not something people would naturally do. People are going to maintain a kind of connection and feeling about the place they came from. If you don't have that, then there's probably something wrong with you. At the end of Fiddler on the Roof, where all of the people have been chased out by the Cossacks, and at the crossroads, the last musical number is Anatyevka, the name of the village. And it's a kind of bittersweet song where this place was terrible. In a sense, they're lucky to be rid of it. On the other hand, it was theirs. It was where they came from. They loved it. And that's a natural human emotion. But it is necessary to get beyond that to have the kind of real sort of deep psychological assimilation that's necessary, and modern technology makes that much more difficult. In the past, you didn't hop on a plane and go to your aunt's funeral in Palermo for a long weekend, or even call. Now you can. And there's nothing wrong with doing this. This is a natural human thing, but it means that that process of uprooting and rerooting doesn't happen in the same way. There's a series of, about Swedish immigrants. There was a movie made out of one of them, Max von Sydow, called The Immigrants, and it's a four-book series in Swedish. It's sort of their version of Roots, kind of. And the final edition in the book is called The Last Letter Home, because the immigrant family had moved to Minnesota or Wisconsin, and over the years had passed, their kids had grown up, they got married, and they got the last letter from home. There is no last letter from home anymore, and there doesn't have to be, and that fundamentally changes the calculus of assimilation. The second factor in assimilation is that, and this is obviously a less desirable change from the past, is that our elites, government, business, philanthropy, media, religion, all of our elites are, to put it charitably, ambivalent about American patriotism. Just to give you one illustration of this, my mother was the daughter of immigrants. She went to public school in Medford, Massachusetts in the 30s and 40s. And her parents brought her to school, and the unspoken compact was the school was going to teach her reading, writing, arithmetic, but also what it is to be an American. They didn't know. They just got here. Immigrant parents make the same tacit compact today. What did my mother learn? She memorized the Gettysburg Address, learned that George Washington was the father of our country, and sang Hail Columbia. Anybody think they're doing that in the LA Unified School District today? Or the New York schools, or Chicago, or Miami, or any of the places that immigrants are living? No. And it's not the immigrants who are doing it. Immigrants aren't coming saying, hey, I demand multiculturalism. It's our elites that are not only permitting this, but encouraging it. Secondly, the second area of this conflict between mass immigration and modern society is security. And again, the same revolution in communications and transportation technology have created a very different security environment, one where the home front isn't just a metaphor anymore, it's the actual front, the one that really matters. Our most immediate enemies are not foreign armies, but rather shadowy terrorist groups, transnational criminal organizations. And as the 9/11 Commission staff report on immigration noted, quote, "It is perhaps obvious to state that terrorists cannot plan and carry out attacks in the United States if they are unable to enter the country." Now, there were equivalents of Al-Qaeda, sort of, in the past, but what could you do 100 years ago? With a horse-drawn buggy and some dynamite in the back. You know, you could blow up something, you could kill some people, and that happened in the past. But the kind of threat that that represented to us and the kinds of threats that we now are facing are qualitatively different. And mass immigration confounds our efforts at maintaining our people's security. And there are two main ways it does this. One, it overwhelms our administrative capacity to screen out bad guys. And number two, it creates and constantly refreshes the insular immigrant communities that unwittingly serve as cover and incubators for bad guys. The bureaucratic overload is pretty clear. The need for bureaucratic screening, security-related screening of immigrants is obvious. Most foreign terrorists have been immigration law violators. We've documented this at great length. And they could have been stopped through routine, consistent immigration enforcement, something which is within our capacity to do if we wanted to do it. The 9/11 hijackers, not a single one of them should have been granted a visa to the United States. Not because somebody magically knew what was in their minds, but because none of them met the basic criteria in our immigration law of having to demonstrate that you have equities back home that will lead you to return and not stay illegally. The Fort Dix plotters, who were stopped before they were able to carry out their attacks, were illegal border crossers. Amin al-Khalifi who plotted to blow up the Capitol, and this was stopped and foiled in 2012. He was, like so many others, a visa overstayer, and without a visa tracking system, we have no idea which people have overstayed their visas and which have not. And this crush is such that all three layers of our immigration security, the visa offices abroad, our Border Patrol agents and border inspectors at the borders, and our ICE officers and USCIS adjudicators inside the country, are overwhelmed and respond in the way that you would expect an overwhelmed bureaucracy to respond. They rubber stamp and wave people through as a kind of act of despair because there's no other alternative for them. The other immigration, the security related issue is safe haven, essentially. That mass immigration creates insular immigrant communities. And this is understood, I think you can understand that by thinking about Mao's aphorism. The people are the sea and the army is the fish that swim in the sea. Well, in the same sense, these insular immigrant communities, whether it's Somalis in Minneapolis, Salvadorans in Washington, constantly reinforced through new immigration, reinforces that separateness and provides a kind of haven, similar to the way Italian immigrant communities provided a kind of haven and breeding ground for the mafia. And when immigration was stopped, those communities assimilated. The American-born young people had a real buy-in. They were Americanized. They no longer were sort of suffused in a Sicilian old world view of the outsider being the enemy. And the kind of threat receded. It makes it harder for the malefactors to find cover, to raise money, to enforce discipline, to recruit sympathizers. There's one author's observation, and this is relevant. He was writing about Chinese criminal organizations, and it applies more generally. He wrote, "If the mass immigration of Chinese should come to a halt, the Chinese gangster may disappear in a blaze of assimilation." Economics. Mass immigration, legal as well as illegal, floods the low-skilled labor market. And this matters because we are a very different kind of economy today. We are no longer settling virgin lands, as Jack Kennedy pointed out in A Nation of Immigrants, which was not intended to increase immigration at all, and yet was used for those purposes. We are not undergoing the process of industrialization. And yet we are importing 19th century labor into a 21st century economy. Now, this isn't to say that Alex is wrong in saying that immigration creates a net economic benefit. It does. George Borjas recently calculated the size of this, and his calculation was that the users of immigrant labor, either their incomes increased or their profits increased to the tune of some $437 billion a year. That's the cheaper lettuce and the cheaper restaurants and all that. It's not all that much cheaper. It's pennies on the dollar for a head of lettuce, for instance. But there is clearly an increase in the income or profits of native-born Americans from immigration. The flip side, though, is that those Americans who compete with immigrants, and they're in fact not complements, they're competitors, see a $402 billion reduction in their incomes. Americans who are the least able to afford this sort of thing. So when you do the math, it's roughly $35 billion net economic benefit to native-born Americans from immigration. This is exactly the same calculation that George Bush's Council of Economic Advisors did and publicized during the debate a number of years back on his immigration bill. There's three problems with this, though. $35 billion is trivial given the size of our economy. The benefit comes from impoverishing the people who can least afford to have their incomes go down. In other words, it's a redistributionist program from the poor to everybody else. And thirdly, the entire set of economic benefits is wiped out by increased social service costs. And that's the fourth issue I'm going to touch on with this conflict between mass immigration and modern society. A century ago, government spending just wasn't all that much. It was more than you tend to think. It was something like about 100 years ago, it was all levels of government, federal, state, and local combined, consumed something like 8% of GDP. Today, it's more than quadruple that share of the economy. Taxes have to support a dramatically greater government sector. Robert Rector of the Heritage Foundation has described this as saying transfer or redistribution are a pervasive, if not predominant, government activity in all modern societies. Now, we can say, like many libertarians, Alex and others say, well, you know, that's right. But so let's get rid of the welfare state and reducing instead of reducing immigration. My answer is knock yourself out. Call me when you get rid of the welfare state, and then we'll have a debate about immigration. It is not going to happen. A large government sector, which I think should be made smaller, tighter, more responsibly run. I'm a conservative. But it's not going away. And it is a kind of, can opener economics, assume a can opener economics, to think that, well, immigration would be great if we only got rid of the welfare state. The can opener joke is a chemist, a physicist, and an economist are isolated on a desert island. There's one can of beans. How do you open it? The chemist says, heat it up, it'll blow up. The engineer says, we'll take a rock and hit it and we'll open it up. And the economist says, it's easy, just assume a can opener. The fact is that each family headed by a high school dropout in the United States receives something like $38,000 more from taxpayers at all government levels, all government programs. $38,000 a year more than he pays in taxes. Essentially, that's the cost of a Mercedes 300 sedan every year from the taxpayers. What that means is every immigrant family that we admit, headed by someone who does not have a high school education, that admission is obligating the American taxpayer to buy him a Mercedes every year. The problem here is not that immigrants are coming here to rip us off. It's that it's the mismatch between their low levels of skill and education and a post-industrial knowledge-based economy that creates this reality. And the idea that we can wall off, as Alex said, wall the immigrants off from the welfare state is a fantasy. If there were less gravity, I could run faster. But on this planet, there isn't any less gravity. And on this planet, we've actually done an experiment attempting to wall immigrants off from the welfare state. That was part of the 1996 welfare reform. And the welfare reform overall was actually quite successful until our current occupant of the White House rolled some of that back. But the immigration parts of it were not successful. Immediately, Congress repealed some provisions of it. Other immigration limitations were simply picked up by the states, so it was just a question of who the immigrant was getting his welfare check from instead of any reduction in welfare. And the immigrant groups that had the highest use of welfare also had the highest increases in naturalization rates after the welfare reform, because once you're a citizen, those immigrant welfare rules don't apply to you anymore. Once you let in a low-skilled person into a modern society, those costs to taxpayers are inevitable, unavoidable. Can't complain about them because you have created the situation where these people are going to be using benefits. And it's not because they're lazy. Work and welfare actually go together now. The overwhelming majority of immigrant households that collect welfare have a worker in them, because welfare is basically designed, especially now, to subsidize people who work, families with young children who work. And that actually is a good proxy for immigrants. So what do we do? Let me just spend a couple minutes. What should immigration policy look like? Legal immigration policy. All immigration flows have three components: families, skills, and humanitarian. Family immigration should be limited to husbands, wives, and little kids of U.S. citizens. Because my sort of starting point in thinking about what immigration policy should be is that we don't need any immigration. But that doesn't mean zero immigration. That means zero-based budgeting. That means you start at zero and then see which groups of people have such a compelling case to be admitted that we let them in anyway. Number one is husbands, wives, and little kids of U.S. citizens. That's a lot of people. That's like a third of today's, maybe even more than a third of today's current immigration flow anyway. Second, genuine Einsteins. People have this idea that our immigration policy already has this sort of Einstein element. We're letting in lots of skilled people, and we are letting in some, there's no question. We're letting in lots of kind of ordinary people with average skills who are not, by any stretch of the imagination, Einsteins. And thirdly, humanitarian immigration. This is a kind of almost government-run charity program, and I'm uncomfortable with anything like that. But if we do it, it should be limited. Congress thought it was voting for 50,000 refugees a year, low these 30-plus years ago when they passed the refugee law. It's never been that low. And it should be confined to people who genuinely have nowhere else to go and never will have anywhere else to go. And that doesn't describe many of the people we admit today as, quote, refugees, unquote. You'd end up with half or less of the current immigration flow, maybe 400,000 or so immigrants a year. It's still more immigrants for permanent settlement in the United States than all the other countries of the world put together. Anyway, it's just a lot less than we have now and reduces the impacts, these counter-modern impacts that immigration has. And let me just say a couple sentences, finally, on how do we get there? Because sort of part of the context of this, as Roger said, is what's going on in the actual policy debate. And I laid this out in an article in National Review earlier this year. And the way it's usually approached, how do we deal with this illegal population? What do we do about legal immigration? Usually the way this is broached is essentially a sort of constantly repeating the deal that we did in 1986, which is legalize all the illegal immigrants up front and then promise to enforce the law in the future. That's essentially what Congress passed last year, as well, the Senate passed last year as well, with the addition of doubling future immigration into that bargain. Instead, those pieces need to be rearranged. Enforcement has to come first, not promised in the future, but actually implemented, rolled out, surviving judicial challenge. Things like universal use of the E-Verify system, visa tracking so that visitors will know when visitors leave. Once that's in place, doesn't solve everything, but it demonstrates a commitment to actually enforce the law. Then we have a different grand bargain than the one that the Gang of Eight and President Obama and John McCain and everybody else wants, which is legalization, amnesty for a significant share of the illegal immigrants who are still here in exchange for deep permanent cuts in legal immigration in the future. Thank you.
Let me begin. I have to begin by apologizing to Roger and to my fellow panelists and to you because a family health problem requires me to dash out of here as soon as I've made my remarks. I find myself agreeing with so much of what both Mark and Alex have said that I must be setting some kind of record for cognitive dissonance.
I'm glad I went second.
Yeah. Hold on a second. We talked about just now about the Senate immigration bill, much discussed and rarely seen. There it is, 1,197 pages. It has to be that long because the senators, as is well known, know everything. They know, for example, what the hourly wage of an immigrant animal sorter in 2016 should be, $9.84, in case you're wondering, which is 20 cents more than the hourly wage of an immigrant nursery worker in 2016. It's all in here. Did you know that Nevada is a border state? You laugh. I know you're thinking about Chico Marx said in the movie Duck Soup, are you going to believe me or your eyes? I know that technically the southern tip of Nevada is 164 miles north of the border, doesn't matter. There's another $20 billion of border security pork in here, and the majority leader of the Senate for another few days wanted Nevada to have its share at the trough. this is what you do when you do comprehensive legislation. You have to pass it in order to find out what's in it, and I've just given you a taste of it. This unimpressive little two-page thing is the Homestead Act of 1862, which in some ways was our first immigration law, and certainly is one of the half dozen or so most important pieces of legislation ever passed. To be fair, the parchment copy in the archives is 4 pages long. Still, it's 1,193 pages shorter than this. This was our first immigration law in the sense that we really had no immigration laws. We had naturalization laws. But the point of the Homestead Act was to attract immigrants to settle that portion of the United States which was identified on many maps at the time, that is all the area west of the Mississippi, as the Great American Desert. It was short because it was simple. It said essentially, come here, work the land for 5 years, we'll essentially give it to you, good luck. And the Homestead Act was actually still in effect and still doing things until about 1970. This is how you don't legislate. What we should learn, of course, with regard to immigration is the lesson of the Compromise of 1850. Henry Clay decided to have a comprehensive solution to America's sectional problems at that time. And so he put together a package that dealt with the Fugitive Slave Act, Texas-New Mexico border, California statehood, and three or four other things. When it failed, Clay took his tuberculosis off to Rhode Island to take the sea breezes, and Stephen A. Douglas of Illinois said, wait a minute, we'll chop this thing up into four or five different pieces of legislation, which he did. There were 60 senators when he started, 62 when he finished, because the California senators arrived. All pieces of the compromise were passed separately, and only four senators voted for all the pieces. Surely we can do the same thing with immigration, understanding that there are three basic questions before us. One is border security. The other is the need of the American workforce. And the third is what to do with the 11 to 12 million illegals who are here. With regard to border security, I simply note that A, border security spending quadrupled in the 90s, tripled again in the next decade, and now has all this stuff in here that got Nevada admitted as a border state. It seems to me we're unlikely to have, and I'm sure Michael Barone will stress this, that we're unlikely to have this kind of surge of immigration that we've had in recent decades. Net immigration from Mexico is what now? Negative for 4 or 5 years now. The border we have a problem with is the southern border of Mexico, which is porous to people making the arduous trip from particularly disorderly societies. With regard to the needs of the American workforce, I'm well aware that Milton Friedman, who I revere as I'm sure all of you do, said that you really cannot have a very liberalized immigration policy and a welfare state because people will come to get on welfare. Maybe, but I think there's precious little empirical evidence that a substantial number of immigrants are coming here for the purpose of getting on welfare. I think immigration is an inherently entrepreneurial act. It's the uprooting oneself and often one's family, taking substantial risks and hardship for the purpose of getting here so they can go to work, which is why the workforce participation rate of illegal immigrants in the United States is higher than that of the American population as a whole. Furthermore, with regard to our needs, the welfare state, of course, exists to transfer wealth from the working young and middle-aged to the retired elderly in the form of pensions and health care. That's fine. When Ida Mae Fuller of Ludlow, Vermont, became in 1940 the first American to receive a regular monthly Social Security check, she presaged our problem because she had paid a grand total of $22 in Social Security taxes and then turned on her country and lived to be 100, collecting in the process $24,000 in Social Security benefits, which didn't matter at that time because there were 40 workers for every retiree. Today, there are three for every retiree. When the baby boomers have all retired in 2030 And the average age of the population coast to coast is higher than it is today in Florida, which is justly known as God's antechamber. At that point, there will be two workers for every retiree. Long story short, we need, in fact, immigration to replenish our workforce, particularly given that we've now had six consecutive years of a declining birth rate, and given the fact that there were fewer births in 2010 in the United States than there were in 2000, although there were 25 million more Americans in 2010. This is a grinding arithmetic that we're going to have to deal with. It is the case, of course, that as has been said, the Declaration of Independence upbraided George III for, among many other things, interfering with the naturalization of immigrants and, quote, refusing laws to encourage their migration hither. But it seems to me, among the things we'd pass if we would chop up the immigration bill into manageable things is the so-called STEM visas for the particularly talented. It is absurd that we have the world's greatest research universities filled with graduate students from overseas who are trained to add an extraordinary value to economies, but not to ours, because then they are then invited to leave. Third, what do we do with the illegals? In politics, surely it is useful to start by facing what is not going to happen. What is not going to happen is they're not going home. I did the arithmetic once. In order to deport 11 million people would require a line of buses bumper to bumper extending from San Diego to Alaska. It is not going to happen. Furthermore, the American people in their native decency would not support the police measures required to make that happen, particularly given the fact that a substantial number of immigrants have been here 5 and even 10 years, and a substantial number, that is millions, have had children here. The children are American citizens. We're not going to deport American citizens or their parents. So where does this leave us? The 11 million illegal immigrants are 5.2% of the American workforce. We're not going to deport 5.2% of the American workforce. We've had this long, meandering, serpentine path to our current discontents on immigration, and they really sort of began in 1882 with the Chinese Exclusion Act, passed in part and other restrictions in response to nativists and nationalists, labor unions, and particularly progressives who, as part of their yen for social engineering, they wanted to control the population, the composition of the population. And, of course, at that time, there were a great many eugenicists among the progressives, and they thought that they knew just who ought to be and who should not be Americans for eugenic reasons. I tend to come down, I think it's clear by now, somewhat closer to Alex than to Mark, noting, for example, that 40% of the corporations on the Fortune 500 list were founded by immigrants or the children of immigrants, including AT&T, Goldman Sachs, Procter & Gamble, Kraft, Google, eBay, Intel, Pfizer, and Cigna. It seems to me we are... One doesn't want to exaggerate the Einstein component or the component of the founders of Fortune 500 companies, but they are a fact. It also is the fact, and I thought Mark was particularly interesting and instructive on the problems of immigration, but of assimilation. I would say this. When Vietnam fell in 1975, after that we took in 1 million Vietnamese, 175,000 of them in a very few weeks. Another surge in 1978 when the boat people began to arrive. The boat people arrived here in the middle of the Carter-era stagflation, one of the worst periods of economic opportunity in American history. By 1982, 4 years later, the employment rate for these Vietnamese boat people was higher than the employment rate for the American population as a whole. The problems with immigration assimilation that Mark mentioned are real, and he is completely right that the problem is not immigrants, it is the elites that have low confidence in and low affection for the United States to which we want these people to assimilate. And it also is the case that, I believe this is Victor Davis Hanson's, phrase, that the Atlantic Ocean was for earlier immigrants a kind of psychological guillotine that severed them from Europe, particularly in the days before Boeing and Airbus democratized air travel. The Rio Grande River doesn't provide such a psychological guillotine. On the other hand, I think assimilation, for better or for worse, is accomplished by American popular culture and that thing that the average immigrant parent probably dreads most of all, the American high school. There is nothing like sex, drugs, and rock and roll to make a young person an American in a hurry. And I have a feeling that that is working. I would simply close by quoting Ronald Reagan from his farewell address to the nation. It is frequently quoted, part where he says, "The city on a hill has walls, but the walls have doors." That's not, however, where his quote ends. The walls had doors, and the doors were, Ronald Reagan said, open to anyone with the will and the heart to get here. That's how I saw it and see it still. I think that puts me somewhat more in Alex's camp than in Mark's, but deeply conflicted all the way. Thank you.
I think I'll talk from here. In the encounter broadside, we have two diametrically opposed views of immigration policy. But both arguments come from the center right. One is libertarian, Alex Naresta, and one is conservative, Mark Ricordi. But immigration cannot be examined in a vacuum, nor is immigration simply about economic policy. 21st century America is in the middle of a regime conflict. The issue is, do we transmit to future generations the American regime, that is limited constitutional government, a free market economy, the individual as opposed to group rights, vibrant civil society, and the Judeo-Christian and Enlightenment cultural heritage? Do we do that, or do we fundamentally transform America into a European-style social democracy? This issue goes way beyond the question of who wins the presidential election in 2016, but concerns the future of the American regime writ large. It's in this context that we're examining immigration policy. Alex and Mark basically agree on the big issue. They would both like to transmit America's limited government regime to the future generations. But how to get there, they obviously can't both be right. And they are speaking totally different languages. Alex, the libertarian, views immigration from the vantage point of the world economy. Specifically, he views it as an economic citizen of the world, an individual global consumer. This individual should be free to make a contract with any other individual anywhere in the world. In this view, in his view, the market trumps. Mark, the conservative, views immigration from the vantage point of national interest, what is good for American citizens. In his scenario, the nation trumps. Alex states that America's core founding principle is the Enlightenment theory of natural rights, and freedom of movement is indispensable to fully use those rights. To restrict an immigrant's ability to move to the United States infringes upon his natural rights and the natural rights of Americans that would like to hire him. Alex tells us this was part of the view of the American founders, and that immigration restrictions cannot be based on either economic protectionism and, very interestingly, in his paper, what he calls cultural protectionism. Can't be based on cultural protectionism. Now, with the exception of those who wish us harm, is global freedom of movement a founding American principle? Well, this question was answered directly by Gouverneur Morris, the author of the preamble of the Constitution. According to Madison's notes on the Constitution, at the Constitutional Convention, Gouverneur Morris said, quote, "Every society, from a great nation down to a club, has the right of declaring the conditions on which new members should be admitted." The founders believed that at the heart of Republican self-government, they were Republican small r as well as Enlightenment liberals, at the heart of Republican self-government is first and foremost the right of a free people to govern themselves. Government by consent of the governed. Illegal immigrants that come into the country are here without the consent of the governed. That's the main problem. This moral right of a self-governing free people obviously have the right to determine their immigration or any other policy and the right to decide the conditions for accepting or assimilating immigrants, as Gouverneur Morris said. It also, of course, means the moral right of a free people to perpetuate their institutions and their way of life. What Alex is basically arguing in his paper is that we, the people of the United States, don't have the moral right to reproduce ourselves or to rule ourselves. Now, the American founders supported what I call patriotic assimilation. There's an interesting letter from President George Washington to Vice President John Adams, November the 15th, 1794. Washington wrote, "My opinion with respect to immigration is that except for useful mechanics in some particular professions, there is no need of encouragement. The policy of settling them in a body may be questioned, for by doing so, they retain the language, habits, and principles, good or bad, which they have brought with them. Whereas by an intermixture with our people, they and their descendants will get assimilated into our customs, measures, and laws. In a word, we will soon become one people." The following year, 1795, Congress passed another Naturalization Act in which it said that immigrants should openly repudiate previous allegiance. I absolutely renounce my allegiance to King George III and so on. It also said that immigrants were to go before a court of admission and to show that they were attached to the principles of the Constitution and of good moral character. Well, Washington's reference to language, habits, customs, the Congress's act in 1795 to good moral character, that doesn't sound very libertarian to me. So in fact, what Washington is endorsing is cultural protectionism. Habits, language, customs, those are cultural things. He's endorsing cultural protectionism. The founders were not simply Enlightenment liberals who believed only in the free market. But as Leo Strauss famously argued, there were two important pre-Enlightenment, pre-liberal, pre-modern residues present at the American founding. One was classical republicanism, and the other was religion. Athens and Jerusalem, that was also part of America. Well, what about assimilation today? Alex states that from the book, quote, "Civic and cultural measures of assimilation are proceeding successfully." He cites a study by Professor Jacob Vigdor on civic assimilation. Vigdor counted, for example, if someone naturalized, became a citizen, okay, civically assimilated. You vote, you're civically assimilated. These are maybe measures of civic assimilation. They're not measures of patriotic assimilation or tell us nothing about the deeper feelings. I could think of one political activist who would be successfully civically assimilated under the Vigdor criteria. His name is Gustavo Torres. He's head of CASA de Maryland. He's a citizen. He votes. He gets other people to vote. Torres spent a good part of the Cold War in Nicaragua assisting the Sandinistas. He's an admirer of Castro's communist regime, which he visited. In 2007, Torres spoke at a conference on revolution in Venezuela, supported by Hugo Chavez. CASA was funded by partly by the Venezuelan government. I would suggest that he is not patriotically assimilated. But in a sense, Torres and CASA are assimilated into today's multicultural framework. CASA did receive funds from the Venezuelan government, but it also receives more funds from the U.S. government and from the state of Maryland. He was on Governor O'Malley's transition team. Raised money from the Ford Foundation, the Open Society Institute. If the Senate Gang of Eight bill had passed, Torres would have received money to help integrate, not assimilate, but integrate immigrants. He's right at the table in President Obama's new, recently announced New Americans program. So I disagree with the idea that assimilation is proceeding just fine if we consider the issue of patriotic assimilation. Now, I agree with Mark and George that this is not the fault of the immigrants, but the fault of American elite. Let's look at some survey data put together for the Bradley Project on American national identity. These questions are deeper than Vigdor's measures of civic assimilation. There are over 20 survey questions on issues of patriotic patriotic attachment that revealed a large gap between native-born and naturalized citizens. I'll give you a few examples. The question was asked, do you consider yourself primarily an American citizen or a citizen of the world? There was a 30-point gap on this question. 84% of native-born said American citizen. 54% of naturalized. They've just taken the oath of allegiance. 54% said American citizens as opposed to global citizens. So a 30-point gap on that question. Another question was asked, if there's a conflict between the U.S. Constitution and international law, what should be the highest legal authority for Americans? There's a 30-point gap on this. Among native-born Americans, 67% said the Constitution should take priority over international law. Among newly naturalized citizens, 37% said the Constitution should take precedence over international law. 30% gap on that. Let's look at a question on education. What do our schools do? Question was, should our schools focus on the rights and responsibilities of citizenship and being part of America as opposed to each student's ethnic identity and their pride in their own ethnic group? There was a 31% gap on this. 81% of native-born Americans said the school should focus more on the rights and responsibilities of citizenship and what has us together as Americans. That was 81% of native-born, but only 49% of new citizens said this. So a 31-point gap on that. Now, as our other speakers have said, and I agree 100%, we should not blame the immigrants for this big patriotic gap, but for American leaps in government, in universities, in schools, and certainly in corporations, for sending newcomers the wrong message. They're telling immigrants to assimilate into multiculturalism, not into American civic patriotism, as they did in the past. George mentioned American high schools. One survey of American high schools showed that it was a survey done when kids entered in the ninth grade, and then when they left, when they graduated, and after 4 years of American high school, they were less likely to consider themselves an American. The question was, you consider yourself mainly an American or a Mexican or Filipino or Latino or something else. The percentage of people supporting, saying they identified considerably as Americans, dropped about 20 points after American high school. So it has a de-Americanizing effect, at least in the patriotic. It might have a Americanizing effect and certain bad aspects of the culture. The past, I mentioned the past. Well, let's go back to the past for a moment. Let's go back to July the 4th, 1915, Philadelphia, an Americanization Day swearing-in ceremony. The President of the United States, Woodrow Wilson, not a fan, I think, of anybody probably at this table or very few people in this room, but so let's listen to the words of President Woodrow Wilson, July the 4th, 1915. He's speaking to new citizens. They've just taken the oath. They've just become Americans. He says to them, you cannot dedicate yourself to America unless you become, in every respect, with every purpose of your will, thoroughly Americans. You cannot become Americans if you think of yourself in groups. America does not consist of national groups. A man who thinks of himself as belonging to a particular national group in America has not yet become an American. And the man who goes among you to trade upon your nationality is no worthy son of the stars and stripes. Who would that be going among? Would that be CASA or La Raza or some other groups? Well, Woodrow Wilson actually sounds quite a bit like George Washington's letter to Adams in his discussion of patriotic assimilation. So I say two cheers for Woodrow Wilson. that was deliberately provocative for this panel. unlike in Woodrow Wilson's day, today's progressive vision of America is group-based. Wilson had he was a nationalist progressive who believed in individual rights. Today's progressives are group-based. Today, progressivism is based on race, ethnicity, and gender. For progressives, the purpose of government is substantive equality for oppressed groups. They seek to eliminate underrepresentation of so-called marginalized groups in all aspects of society, public and certainly private. 21st century progressivism promotes multiculturalism, coercive diversity, bilingualism through government coercion. The progressive vision of immigration must be seen in this context. The conservative vision of immigration presented by Mark, I think, is an anecdote to the progressive project. I see the libertarian vision presented by Alex as the unwitting handmaiden of the progressive immigration project. Now, Alex said that forthcoming research from the Cato Institute on, they have some research coming on ideological opinions. And this apparently shows a rapid assimilation, particularly in the third generation. I assume that means more libertarian meanings. However, if the perpetual mass immigration continues, these third generation libertarian gains would be wiped out. We look forward to the Cato research, but in the meantime, let's look at some other current research on ideological opinions. The following question was asked by Pew. Would you rather have a bigger government with higher taxes and more services, or a smaller government with fewer taxes and fewer services? Among the general public, the result was 48% smaller government, 41% larger government. Among immigrant Latinos, the number was 81% bigger government, 12% smaller government. Among all Latinos, it was 75% larger government. Among Asians, 55% bigger government. Among Muslims, 68% bigger government. On social issues, immigrants and the general public are roughly the same. For example, on the question, do you support abortion for anyone who wants it? General public is 31%. Immigrants are 28%, so within the margin of error. But not much different on social issues. Sometimes we hear that's an issue, but it doesn't appear to be. Professor James Gimple of the University of Maryland found in his survey that in all countries all counties in the United States where the immigrant share of the vote has increased, including Texas and Florida, the Republican percentage of the presidential vote has decreased. Now, the argument is made that these voting patterns will eventually change, and of course they will. Today's Latino immigrants are much like yesterday's Italian immigrants. Conservative values of family and hard work and so on, this will change voting habits. Now, at one of these panels about 5 or 6 years ago, I asked Michael Barone how long it took before Italians started voting for Republicans in, say, numbers nearing 50% or so. If I remember his answer, he said something like, and this was, I think, in his book, something like, oh, about 70 years or so. And so I think I remember asking him, well, you want to wait that long? He can correct me. And it's coming
that,
on
that was 50 years ago.
It was 6 years ago. In the future, as immigrants succeed, of course, as they will, they'll join the middle class. And they'll be open to Alex's arguments and to Mark's arguments. But the problem today is the continuing influx of low-skill immigrants, and people are coming from Central America and elsewhere, even if Mexico's dropped off. This overall increase of low-skill immigrants will keep the conservative libertarian percentage down. California was once a conservative state in the days of Governor Ronald Reagan. Remember him, Governor? If we continue perpetual mass immigration policies, contemporary California will be the political future of the United States. Now, according to Joel Kotkin, who's a liberal democratic journalist, California today is a neo-feudalist society run by a small oligarchical class in the Silicon Valley and Hollywood. These feudalists, these oligarchs, are ideologically defended by a new clerisy. That'd be like the old clergy of feudal days. This new clerisy consists of academics, government officials, and progressive intellectuals. And then you have the vast majority. Kotkin uses the term serfs to go with this feudalist analogy. And the oligarchs and the clerisy are served by a large number of low-skilled people who aren't led into the gated valleys the gated communities of Silicon Valley, and they include native-born and immigrants. And they have little chance of upward mobility if the prevailing oligarchical institutions of California remain in effect. So is that the future? Let's hope not. So why did immigration succeed and assimilation succeed in the 20th century. Americanization by elites, yes, that was part of it. But that really wasn't the big reason. The big reason it succeeded, that immigration and assimilation was so successful in the 20th century, was the passage of immigration restriction legislation in 1924, signed and supported by President Calvin Coolidge, who very much believed in natural rights, by the way. This Coolidge-supported measure cut mass immigration, ended perpetual immigration, and clearly facilitated the assimilation process. It certainly did in my Italian family. This action is almost never discussed for obvious reasons. Some of the supporters of the restrictions advanced arguments of Northern European racial superiority and prejudice against Southern Europeans, Italian, Eastern Europeans, Asians, and others. So there was a whole range of baggage coming with some of the arguments, not all of the arguments. This was not the argument that Coolidge used as president. He opposed the Japanese exclusion provision and various racial provisions. He did favor limiting overall legal immigration to facilitate assimilation. Coolidge, in his address to Congress, December the 6th, 1923, said, American institutions rest solely on good citizenship. New arrivals should be limited to our capacity to absorb them into the ranks of good citizenship. So Coolidge is really echoing the views expressed by the American founders, by Washington's letter to Adams, by progressive Woodrow Wilson, speaks to immigrants in 1915. They're all of one on this. You want to see where the American founders stood in immigration? I'd say suggest you pick up a book by Tom West called Vindicating the Founders. And he has a whole chapter on immigration and very much disagrees with what Alex has presented today. He, of course, I guess is known as a West Coast Straussian. Well, Coolidge found the immigration restriction legislation of 1924 because if you believe more time was needed to Americanize the immigrants already present. My Sicilian relatives at the time opposed this legislation because, in general, it greatly limited immigration from Italy. There were family provisions, but it greatly limited immigration from Italy overall. But Coolidge's judgment that cutting legal immigration would facilitate the goal of Americanization and the goal of the perpetuation of America's constitutional limited government regime was ultimately sound. On the current solution of the version, I agree. I support something along the lines of the Barbara-Jordan plan of the 90s, which Mark outlined a little bit in his book and a little bit here today. And I will stop there. Thank you.
I'll take the podium here. I don't have a 1,997-page piece of legislation to show you, or even a four-page I find myself in disagreement. Which one of these things? Why do we have two microphones? So I can speak out of both sides of my mouth? I don't know. I guess I find myself in at least some disagreement with each of the preceding speakers. Unlike Alex Nowresta, I am a Westphalian. I think that the Westphalian state, Henry Kissinger makes reference to that in his latest volume, World Order, I think has every right to exclude everybody if it wants to. We don't have to allow immigrants. We don't have moral responsibility even to allow visitors. Prudentially, we tend to do so or have done so over our history, and I think wisely so. But I don't see that we have a moral obligation to people and to let anybody in that wants to get in. I find myself in disagreement with Mark Krikorian and also with George Will's agreement of him. I think they overestimate the degree of in which immigrants in the 19th and first half of the 20th century kept in touch with their countries of origin. No, they didn't have Skype, but in fact, at least the research I've done suggests that letters did pass back and forth, and actually post offices operated more efficiently in those days than they do now in this country and other places. Foreign language newspapers and Irish revolutionary publications kept people in touch with movements in their countries of origin. There was a lot among some immigrant groups of sojourner immigration, where people came here for a while, worked at a job, and then went back to their country of origin. So that in the by the 1950s and 60s, the primary economic sustenance of many communities in southern Italy and rural Greece were social security checks, the entitlement to which had been picked up in diners in New Jersey or some such occupation over the years. People went back and forth. Some ethnic groups did not. Fiddler on the Roof, which Mark referenced, is a version of the inspired by the Jewish experience. Jewish immigrants from Eastern Europe almost never went back, except those who wanted to build communism in the Soviet Union. They were liquidated in time, almost all of them, and so that was not a recurring problem. But the Jews never really wanted to go back to Eastern Europe and so forth, and much of the history, the vivid history of immigration of that period is written by writers like Oscar Hanlon, for whom the Jewish experience was the sort of paradigmatic experience. Well, it was one experience. It wasn't the only experience. So I guess I disagree on that point with John Fonti, my fellow Sicilian-American. I will only remind him that he may want to remember how good it feels to walk down the street when your kneecaps work the right way. I disagree about whether or not the pause caused by the Immigration Act of 1924, Alex might call it, the totalitarian imposition of state force against the free will of individuals, vastly promoted assimilation. I think, to indulge in a little counterfactual history, if we had not had that Immigration Act of 1924, when you look at the numbers, it did definitely reduce immigration over the calendar years 1925 through 1930. I think that in the years of the Great Depression, when even those very limited country quotas were often not met, there just wasn't much. We would not have had much immigration between 1930 and 1945, admittedly a whole series of events that most people in 1924 didn't anticipate. We would have had some more immigration in the immediate post-World War II years when Europe was in ruins, but I think that actually it did not reduce numbers. I think the reason we had assimilation working, and I agree with John here, relatively better than it's worked in the that it's working at the present time, was that we had elites and institutions that believed in Americanization, and even professors turned president, as this example of Woodrow Wilson shows, tended to believe in that. We have not been so lucky in our adjunct professor turned president more recently. I do have disagreements here. I try to see this issue through something of an historical lens, both because I think that that's a better way to understand it, and because I want to plug my 2013 book, Shaping Our Nation, How Surges of Migration Transformed in America and Its Politics, which George made reference to in his comments. And that book looks at both internal migration and international immigration. I thought they had some things in common, because what you see in the course of American history is that the country is peopled in very large part by vast surges of migration, very large numbers of people moving unexpectedly and without predictions by experts from one place, whether it's abroad or a region within the country, to another place in very large numbers. They start off unexpectedly. They move, these movements last just about one or two generations. Then they tend to suddenly stop, sometimes because of exogenous events like the passage of legislation or the onset of war, sometimes just because they just stop. And I think the reasons that propelled so many to migrate suddenly become, in the words that we learned during the Nixon administration, inoperative, and they cease coming. We often analyze immigration, migration as an economic phenomenon, and you can certainly see that it increases, decreases to some extent. It's responsive to the business cycle, as I suggested in my comments about 1930s. But I think that there's something else involved. Immigration is an unnatural act, as George suggested. Uprooting yourself, going somewhere else, is something that random numbers of individuals do at any given time. But mass movements that inspire a lot of people, I think, are rooted not just in economics. You don't have huge masses of people moving because they increase the minimum wage by $1.25 an hour, or its historic equivalent. People move for reasons that are spiritual, cultural. They migrate, as I tried to put it in the book, in large number. When you see migrations in large numbers, people are moving in order to pursue dreams or escape nightmares. When those dreams cease to be enchanting or the nightmares cease to be frightening, mass immigration can stop, and just as suddenly as it began. We can't analyze dreams or nightmares just by economic criteria, though that plays some role, but rather by trying to understand what goes on not just in people's heads, but in their hearts. And in Shaping Our Nation, I looked at some of the historic migrations, the huge migration of Scots-Irish from Northern Ireland, Lowland Scotland, and other parts of the Northern British Isles. That goes on. It had started a little bit in early 18th century, but you had huge numbers as a proportion of pre-existing population in the 12 years between 1763, the end of the war known in North America as the French and Indian War, a war named after its losers. Never thought of that before, but the fact is true. The outbreak of the American Revolution in 1775, they went down. This was Andrew Jackson's parents who left Northern Ireland, Belfast, Lough, in 1765, and they go down the great wagon road of the Shenandoah Valley. The sensible colonists on the American seaboard didn't want these ruffians fighting peoples. From the Godot there, and they go down through there, settle the Carolinas, Kentucky, and Tennessee. They go on basically to acquire Florida, Texas, get rid of the Indians in the southeastern United States, not what we consider today the noblest episode in American history, and eventually start the Mexican War, which gives us, now regrettably, California. And so forth. That ends with the war. It doesn't really resume. John was quoting the founders. We don't get a lot of immigration in the early years of the Republic, partly because Europe was at war and seaborne commerce was kind of risky. But then we get this big surge starting in the 1840s of Irish Catholics and of Germans, Protestant and Catholic. The Irish come here really to escape a nightmare, the famine in Ireland. The 1841 census showed the island of Ireland with 8 million people. It's about 5 million today. There's not many other parts of the world that have been depopulated by famine, cataclysm, and mass emigration, as Ireland has. And so forth. We have the Germans who, the Irish settle primarily in cities. They're the first mass migration, whether it's internal or immigrant, to do so. The Germans go to farms. Some of them are attracted by the Homestead Act. We have the resettlement of Sweden and Norway and Minnesota and Wisconsin, the Dakotas. I'm always told when somebody says, well, you know, the socialism would work here because it works in Sweden. And my response is, yeah, but that would work here if we had 318 million Swedes. In fact, probably may work in Minnesota, but the other 49 states is problematic. But those came there. We had significant problems assimilating the Irish, particularly. I feel a little more comfortable saying that with Irish American ancestors, with Irish ancestors, and high rates of crime, violence, substance abuse, and so forth. We get a nativist politics in the 1850s, the American Party, suddenly comes up. It's sort of shoved aside by the Republican Party, which had, in my view, the political good sense to find an anti-immigrant to nominate in 1860 an Illinois lawyer named Abraham Lincoln. Immigrants give him his margin of votes that he needs to carry those northern states that elected him president. That Irish and German immigration went on, the surge continued for about a half century, somewhat interrupted by the Civil War, but not as much as you might think. And it sort of peters out in the 1880s. Ireland ceases to be as much of a nightmare. Germany is growing and so forth, politically unifying. And we get suddenly, just about at the time the Ellis Island Immigration Station opens in 1892, and the federal government is taking over the responsibility of screening immigrants to make sure that they are healthy, do not have contagious diseases, and are self-supporting, we get immigration suddenly comes from different sources. Unexpectedly, once again, a big surge from the multi-ethnic nations of Eastern and Southern Europe. What you get then, interestingly, is the second caste citizens in these empires. Jews and Poles from the Russian and German Empire, Poles, Czechs, Slovaks, Croats, Slovenes from the Austro-Hungarian Empire, Southern Italians from Northern-run Kingdom of Italy. And I think, in some extent, these people were pursuing a dream of a sort of equality. These are the years of nationalist discontent in Europe, of people who are in minorities like the Jews being treated negatively and seeking different treatment. America was held out not only as a place of economic opportunity, which it certainly was, and where the unskilled could move up more rapidly, but a nation that where you could have first-class equal citizenship. That ideal continued. The Ellis Island immigration, which ends abruptly in 1914, resumes for a few years after the war and things settle down, is like the Irish and German immigration of the mid-19th century and like the Scots-Irish immigration of the dozen years before the American Revolution. It is larger in magnitude as a percentage of pre-existing population than any of the immigration that we've seen for the last 30 years. It's 2 to 3 times as large. The problems of assimilation, the challenges of assimilation are not unfamiliar. They seem daunting to many Americans. In the case of the Ellis Islanders, the thought was, gee, we can assimilate these Northwestern Europeans because they basically come from our culture, but these other peoples, they're never really going to be Americans. I think that the country generally handled that successfully. As I've mentioned, I don't think that the passage of the 1924 Act, which set country quotas on different countries proportionate to that country's contribution to the American population in 1890, in other words, Ellis Islanders need not apply for the most part. I don't think that that was critical in assimilation, though it may have been some marginal assistance for reasons stated. I do think that our problems with immigration today are in many ways offspring of the 1924 Act and of subsequent acts of Congress that have had unexpected results, in part because we don't anticipate either the beginning or the end of the surges of migration, which have continued to occur. Internal migration, but relevant to this topic today, immigrant migration. The 1924 Act gave us family reunification provisions. Why was that true? Because a lot of Republicans and Democrats who voted for this measure had constituents that were Ellis Islanders. They weren't political idiots. They said, okay, these people, you know, my constituents may want collateral relatives to come in, so I'll be able to tell them there's an exception. And then when we passed the 1965 Immigration Act, sponsored on the Senate floor by Senator Edward Kennedy, then serving the first full term in the U.S. Senate, that was granted to him by the voters of Massachusetts in their wisdom, measuring that, the 65 Act, hey, we're going to repeal the 24 Act. The big impetus comes from Ellis Islanders, really. I mean, the sponsors in the House are Peter Rodino and Emanuel Seller, Italian and Jewish, representing those constituencies. But of course, by 1965, that's not what we get in immigration. The experts testified in 1965, we're not going to have substantial Latin or Asian immigration. Immigrants come from Europe. That's where they've always come from. That's where they'll come from in the future. But instead, the family reunification provisions carried over and adapted from the 1924 Act and the 1965 Act eat up the law. The 65 Act actually imposes limits, country quotas on Latin immigration. My recollection is the country quota for Mexico is 60,000 a year. We were getting about 10 times that many Mexicans in the years between 1982 and 2007, legal and illegal, through family reunification and so forth. And I think that was the so you ended up having this unanticipated surge of migration coming from where a place where it hadn't come before. You know, the Rio Grande has never been a really wide river. But people haven't been coming, you know, people didn't come across it and remain in the United States in any large numbers in those years. And we, you know, didn't have border control. I once interviewed Lloyd Benson Sr., father of the Texas senator and treasury secretary who settled in Lower Rio Grande Valley in the early 1920s and bought up land. I said, what was border enforcement like in the 1920s? He said, border enforcement? What? You just go across the bridge. That was, I mean, whatever. This was not, we didn't get streams of Mexicans. The dreams had not been created. The economic incentives were there in the 1920s. The dreams had not been contemplated, which happened now. That's, Mark mentioned some of the 1986 bill and the fact that subsequent legislative proposals have had basically a similar formula, legalization, employer sanctions, and so forth. And we have seen these bills were passed, and one passed the Senate in 2006, these so-called comprehensive things. In 2007, the incoming and now, alas, outgoing Senate Majority Leader Harry Reid screwed up the bill and managed to flummox it and not pass it in the Senate in 07. A similar legislation passed in 2013. All this legislation was concocted in response to situations that occurred at that time. I tended to support those bills. I tend not to support them now. And I think, you know, I've changed my views. Lord Keynes once said when accused of changing his views, so when the facts change, I change my mind. What do you do, sir? I've changed my views. When we were considering, when we were concocting what I'll call for abbreviated purposes, comprehensive bills, the assumption was that the surge was going to continue. Nothing was going to stop it. And that there would be a continued demand or need for market for low-skilled labor in the United States. And Mexicans, people from Mexican origin, immigrants from Mexican origin, both legal and illegal, tend to have the lowest skill levels on average, lowest levels of education and so forth of any group, lower, significantly lower than other Latin sources of immigration. The proximity of the border is probably one factor here. It's easier for low-skilled Mexicans to get to this country than other people. In that background, I thought that, as George said, we aren't going to deport 12 million people. The illegal population peaked at about 12 million in 2007. And so I wasn't worried about incentivizing further illegal immigration. I was hoping that technology could, such as Mark mentioned, could improve enforcement in both borders and workplaces. It seems to me now that when you've got, you've got a credit card that will, you can buy a $50,000 car with your credit card and that whole system works. Is it possible that the government could create an electronic system that works? Of course, there's been some evidence to the contrary in recent years, but it seemed to me that that was possible. And the And it seemed to me that, you know, I tended to go along with this bill, which had accumulated a whole series of lobbies. You know, they had the Hispanic lobby supporting the legalization provisions. You had the high-tech lobby supporting H-1B visas, which brings people to their specific companies. That was, you know, the farm. You had farm provisions that the farm lobby did. And one of the reasons we get these comprehensive bills is that they will bring them all together in one package and pass it with the force of the lobbies. The other procedure, as George said, is to disaggregate the bills and do it Stephen A. Douglas's way. What he didn't add is that Stephen A. Douglas, who would never have favored prohibition if he'd lived that long, after he passed those five different bills, went on a three-day bender. Resumed. So there was some there was some cost to passing things that way. I think it's time to disaggregate. I think that these things have changed. That facts have changed. We have seen from the inrush of Central Americans to the border this summer in the current situation, the surge is over. Net migration from Mexico to the United States between 2007 and 2012 was zero. The surge ended as suddenly as these earlier surges, as suddenly as the surge of internal migration of southern blacks, rural southern blacks, to the urban north, which went on from 1940 to 65. It ended suddenly when the north stopped seeming like such a dream with the riots and things, and the south stopped seeming, because the passage of civil rights acts and the effectiveness thereof, south stopped seeming to be such a nightmare. When those things changed, a surge that seemed likely to go on forever suddenly stopped. I think we saw the same thing with Mexicans. There's been some resumption of Mexican and Central American migration. We now get more Asian than Latin migrants. That's a big shift and change from the situation in which this legislation was put together. I agree with Mark that we should move from low-skill to high-skill immigration, that we have gone too far in family unification, which has created a sort of, as such legislation often does, unintended consequences. I believe that we should adopt something in the nature of the Canadian or Australian high-skill systems, where they have point systems to admit immigrants. This is not Alex's favorite at all.
Better than what we have now.
Well, I think it's better than what we have now. And if you know, do we want MIT and Caltech PhD recipients to stay in this country or to go back somewhere else? I think it's kind of a good idea to admit them. I know I've talked to diplomats from Canada about this. They said to me, please, please do not adopt our immigration system. We want these people in Vancouver and Calgary and Toronto and Montreal. We don't want them in the United States. I think that's a pretty good argument for us to act. It seems to me that in a situation now where in the short and medium term, the need for low-skill immigrants, the market for them, is much weaker than it was before 2007. It has continued to be, even in a period of economic growth. I think we want to move towards the high-skill immigration. I think that, you know, the H-1B visas, which have been a proxy for this, they tend to tie people to a particular company. I don't think that's a maximal, that reeks of indentured servitude. Why not let them take their chances in something that we still have to some extent, which is called the American Free Enterprise System? We always need more high-skilled people, I think. And if high-skill wages are slightly inclined downward by bringing in more high-skilled people, which, like Alex, I don't believe will happen, but if it is, I think they can grin and bear it for the national needs. I think that we've seen on legalization, we have seen President Obama's Dreamers campaign year legalization in 2012. That polled well. Most Americans favor it. The practical effects are that it's not going to be reversed. I think that's similar to President Obama's more recent and less popular quasi-legalization thing. But I'm influenced by the recent writings of Peter Skerry on this, where he makes the point that an awful lot of illegal immigrants want legal status, not necessarily interested in citizenship. The 1986 legalization provisions, only about half of those eligible naturalized and chose to become American citizens, despite the effort of the Clinton administration to get them to naturalize and register Democratic. We're seeing many illegals and legals are like their 19th, early 20th century equivalent sojourners. They intend to go back to Honduras, at least when the crime rates go down, or to Jalisco. And they're not necessarily there. And finally, I would just say that in support of my proposition to go toward the Canadian and Australian system, Canada and Australia currently have higher percentages of immigrants in their population than we do. They admit higher percentages as a percentage of pre-existing population than we do. They also have had more economic growth in recent years. They have higher PISA scores on tests than we have. And for those conservatives and Republicans who are worried that America will tilt towards the Democratic Party, both Australia and Canada currently have conservative governments. They've proved to be at least robustly competitive in countries with increased immigration. So I think we ought to break up the lobbies, disaggregate the legislation, and try to adapt to the current situations, to the fact that the surge of Latin migration, in my view, that we saw one generation, 82 to 07, is not going to return in current form, and let's shape our immigrations in a way that will shape our nation better.
Thanks for inviting me here. There's been so much said and written here to agree with and admire, and I don't think feeling that way is a function necessarily of cognitive dissonance. I think it's more, it owes more to the notion that this is a complicated human problem. And most of those kinds of problems, and I say this, I come at this not as a historian or an analyst of immigration in any way. My perspective is from the perspective of the law and law enforcement in particular. And I think that most complicated societal problems don't get solved because they're too dynamic. They get managed. And if there's cognitive dissonance here, it's because I'm usually on the other side of that argument. I'm usually the terrorism guy. In fact, this is a welcome respite because this is my torture week. I think it's delightful to be able to speak about illegal immigration instead today. But what often we have to look at in national security is whether the normal means that we have to manage problems fit a threat that in some ways can be an existential threat. And where I usually am in these arguments is focused on the folly of trying to use, for example, the criminal justice system as the point of the counterterrorism sphere when the mechanisms of the criminal justice system are not designed to deal with a threat like that. In this instance, I think the opposite is true. And I guess I want to shout out three cheers for Mitt Romney. Not Mitt Romney in his more recent incarnation as an advisor on these matters, but Mitt Romney, the candidate, in 2012, because I think he really got a raw deal on this particular issue for saying what I think is the only sensible and humane immigration policy. And he referred to it as voluntary deportation. And I think by labeling it that way, he didn't get a fair hearing. But I think what he simply meant is we have a finite amount of law enforcement resources. And in classical prosecutorial discretion, not prosecutorial discretion the way that I think President Obama has warped that doctrine over the last 6 years into a sort of a license to mutilate the law. Prosecutorial discretion is just a resource allocation doctrine that's peculiar to criminal law enforcement. And what it holds is that we have a finite number of resources and a much wider amount of crime and criminals, so that we try to sensibly target the resources to the worst of the problems so that we get the best bang for our buck. And Romney's position on this, I think, was target your enforcement resources to the worst of the problem. And that would be, on the one hand, illegal immigrants who are in our country and who violate not just the immigration laws, but who widely violate the criminal laws of the state. We have enough homegrown criminals. We don't need to have the criminals of the rest of the world here. To the extent that you have deportation resources targeted at them, the magnet for illegal immigration is the hiring of illegals. So if you're going to make that, if we're going to have a national position that is lawless, then you have to enforce that against the businesses that hire in order to depress the incentive to come. And therefore, you don't have to worry about the fact that you have 11 or 12 million illegal aliens. For the most part, those people are productive and they're not a problem, and they'll be left alone. And if they decide to leave because the conditions of finding viable employment are not fruitful, then they'll leave on their own. They'll voluntarily depart. And that way you reduce the illegal immigrant population to something that's more manageable. And at that point, when the problem gets significantly below 11 or 12 million people, if you want to talk about amnesty, then you're having a more sensible conversation about amnesty than trying to do it under circumstances where you're not only giving amnesty to 12 million people, you haven't demonstrated any intention to enforce the border. You're really inviting more to come, and you're making a problem that's currently manageable much more mismanageable. And I think at the core of that, and I must confess I'm puzzled by this, the core of the argument seems to be that there is an obligation on our part to do something to relieve the conditions of the illegal immigrant. And I frankly just don't understand that. I mean, as a number of the panelists have pointed out, illegal immigration is a voluntary act. And if you come here, I'm not talking about the dreamers. There are categories of people who you can say it's not their fault that they're in the status that they're in. But a person who comes here illegally and chooses to live in an outlaw status has created that situation on his own. And I just don't understand why we think we have some kind of an obligation to fix that. It seems to me that the sensible way to deal with this, again, is to go after the people who really violate our laws, target the magnet, and try to reduce the population by giving people an incentive to leave. And then once we get down to something that makes more sense, then we can talk about whether we ought to have amnesty or not. So I think it's unfortunate that Romney got routed on that particular issue because it was bad labeling more than anything else. I think it was good policy. What I would like to make a pitch for is states' rights and state sovereignty. Where I think the immigration problem really goes off the rails is the notion that it is a federal issue primarily. Justice Roberts, in a 2011 case called the Whiting case, one of the litigations that involved illegal immigration and Arizona's exercise of powers to try to regulate it, began the opinion by saying the power to regulate immigration is unquestionably a federal power. Well, it may at this point unquestionably be a federal power, But for the first century plus of constitutional governance, it was exclusively a state problem. That is immigration enforcement. The Constitution only gives the Congress the power to set the terms of naturalization. And in fact, we didn't even have a Justice Department for almost the first century of constitutional governance. The assumption at the time of the founding was that the ingress and egress of people into the borders of the states was an issue for the states, that the policing of matters within the states was something that was going to be a matter for the exercise of state power, and that included how hospitable or not hospitable to be to people who weren't American citizens and didn't have a right to be there. Just to give an example, in 1837, in a case called New York against Milne, which involved the state of New York expelling arriving illegal aliens, the Supreme Court said the states had the power to prevent her citizens from being oppressed by the support of multitudes of poor persons who come here from foreign countries without possessing the means of supporting themselves. And the court goes on to indicate that there couldn't be a more appropriate exercise of the state's police power. So for a long time, we operated under the understanding that this was really a states' rights issue. Eventually, the courts rationalized a federal regulatory role. They found it implicit in certain parts of the Constitution, implicit in the power to control borders, which is a core ingredient of sovereignty. So they found a federal role. But this, I think, and I would argue, is where our jurisprudence really has gone awry, particularly in the last century. It's one thing to have a federal role. It's quite another thing to divine a federal role and then, once having divined it, decide that it basically vanquishes the powers of every other actor in the system. The Supreme Court does this by means of the preemption doctrine. So they identify a federal role, and then, as we saw in the Arizona cases, what they say is if the state passes laws or regulations that contravene the federal, first it was federal statutes. In the Arizona cases, what they argued was that it was federal policy. In other words, it didn't matter what Congress's statute said. What mattered was Obama's policy of non-enforcement of the immigration laws. So you had the crazy situation of you had state laws that had been passed, which actually bolstered congressional statutes regulating illegal immigration, and the federal government, the Obama administration, the Justice Department comes into court and says to the states, no, 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 you don't have to comply with federal law, you have to comply with federal policy. So we've now gone from the point of state supreme on immigration enforcement to you have a federal role, to the federal role somehow becomes supreme, and now to the point where, I guess I'm going down like Obama's policies, but now to the absurd situation where you have a president who says, I don't need to enforce the federal law because I have prosecutorial discretion, and you, the states, can't do anything to defend yourselves from whatever the problems are that you get from illegal immigration because that contravenes my policies, even if it's consistent with federal law. In the Arizona case, the more recent one, Justice Scalia posed a hypothetical. He said, if in drafting the Constitution, the framers had attempted to grant Congress the power, and this is a quote, to establish limitations upon immigration that will be exclusive and that will be enforced only to the extent the president deems appropriate, what would have happened? And, of course, what would have happened is there would have been no Constitution, there would have been no United States, there would have been no adoption of our foundational law. It simply wouldn't have happened. So I think to the extent we have an immigration problem, and again, I don't think it's I really don't think it's a crisis. I think it's something that we've fabricated into a crisis. I think it's something that that we're equipped to manage. I would prefer to manage it by federalism, but I think we're certainly equipped to manage it through the criminal justice system. But I think to the extent you can call this a big problem or a crisis, it's due to the federalization of enforcement and the folly of imposing one immigration policy on 50 states with an infinite number of cultural frameworks and economic markets. If I had my druthers, I would have on the federal side a humanitarian enforcement policy, prosecutorial discretion targeted again at real lawbreakers, and obviously make it clear that the federal government is responsible for border security, which is, again, a core ingredient of sovereignty. And then I would say the federal government ought to be deferential to state sovereignty in terms of granting legal status or not to people who are in their territory, which goes to the point Michael was making a few moments ago about, you know, whether people really want citizenship as opposed to legal status. The states obviously don't have the ability to grant citizenship, but I think we should be deferential to them in terms of their decision-making about who's welcome in their territory or not, provided that they are not permitted to socialize the costs of having a hospitable immigration policy. If they want to have a lavish welfare state and lavish benefits for illegal aliens and a welcomeness to illegal aliens that may have a depressing effect on employment for low-wage people in their own borders, I think they can have it, and they should be able to have it, but they shouldn't be able to pass the costs along to everyone else. If we insist on having this crazy central planning, George Will's 1,197 pages, I'd go back to voluntary deportation as the model. I'm persuaded by the Milton Friedman argument that you can't have both free immigration and the welfare state. I respectfully disagree with George Will's comments on that. I mean, I take his point that the welfare state is not necessarily what motivates people to come here. But I don't think what motivates them is relevant. The fact is, once they get there, they're exploiting the welfare system, and we have to bear the cost of it. So reading their minds is not what I'm all that interested in. I agree with Mark that the modern welfare state complements low-wage work with welfare. We're no longer in a paradigm where it's work or welfare. We're not in that kind of a framework. So if we have to have this remain a federal issue, I'm more in the Mark Krikorian camp. I'd love to see the welfare state reformed too. And if I had to make a choice, I'd have free and open immigration with a limited welfare state, or at least a welfare state transferred back to the states where it's closest to the conditions that people actually live in. But since we're not anytime soon, I think, going to do any real reform of the welfare state, and we are stuck, it appears, that with this federal supremacy in immigration enforcement, I think we're much better off with zero-based immigration, as Mark proposes, than free and open immigration. Thank you very much.
Well, thanks to everyone. I'd like first to give Alex and Mark a chance to respond to one another and the panelists to respond to each other, and then we can have a few questions. So, Alex, do you want to do you have anything to say?
Yeah. 5 minutes?
Just a few minutes, yeah.
Well, thank you very much. I guess I'll just start at the end and work myself forward back to me. The Milton Friedman quote was brought up quite a bit. He said you can't have open borders or free immigration in a welfare state. The second part of that quote is that's why he supports illegal immigration.
He supports illegal immigration, in his sense, because they can't get welfare, but you still get the economic benefits of it. So everybody who supports immigration restrictions or harsh enforcement seems to forget that part of the quote afterwards. As when it comes to governments, whether governments have the right to impose immigration restrictions or put these barriers on there, I think that, and I think Andrew framed it properly. It's powers. It's not rights. Governments don't have rights. No government has rights. Governments have powers under our constitutional system. That's how we understand this system going forward. Individuals and the voluntary organizations they form have rights. So governments do not have the rights to restrict immigration. They, by definition, have the power to do so under what it is now. Now, we heard a lot about sort of the American early immigration attitudes toward immigration. Almost everything that was mentioned in that by John has to do with naturalization, which is a separate issue. I think it is perfectly compatible for somebody to say we should have free and open immigration, but naturalization should be very difficult or should only be birthright citizenship or some other issue like that. And it's also important to distinguish between encouragement, which is a subsidy, and free and open, which is not a subsidy. I do not favor the subsidization of immigration. I do not think that government policy should favor immigration by giving them some cash payment once they come here or giving them other preferential treatment, but they should be free to make the decisions based on what the market or other situations have here. And I also want to agree with Andrew on something else. He supports sort of 50 different immigration policies. The federal government saying naturalization. I would go a bit further. I favor about 300 million individual immigration policies in the United States in the same way that I favor 300 million different individual policies on which kind of toothpaste to buy or any other sort of economic transaction of who to engage in voluntary commerce with. So I would go a little bit farther than him in terms of the scale. Fundamentally, I just do not have the confidence that government will be able to choose which immigrants in the future are good for us or which are not. And I think this feeds in directly to what Michael Barone's comments are. The government and society, experts, all of us, and the people who preceded us who were supposedly experts on immigration, were not able to predict the start or end of any of these waves. They weren't able to predict what the needs of the economy would be presently, let alone in the future. So I don't know why, since we're all skeptical of government control over other portions of the economy, that we should therefore somehow assume that they have the power to make the right choices in terms of what immigration will be needed going forward into the future. I think that's why we need a fairly open and flexible system that's guided by market principles, that's guided by supply and demand, not what government bureaucrats, politicians, or supposed experts think supply and demand should be, is, or will be in the future. And this goes to another quote by Lord Keynes, who I'm a big fan of, his quotations, not his economics. He wrote a book in the 30s basically about the economics of his grandchildren, what would occur when he was his grandchildren. He assumed that everything would be so mechanized and so automated that nobody would have to work, that his grandchildren would basically sit back and read poetry and be obsessed with ballet. While as somebody who I guess would be the great-grandchild of Keynes, if I were directly related, that's definitely not the case yet. It may be in the future that technology will supplant the need for low-skilled migrants in the U.S. economy, but we should again let the economy make that decision of when that occurs. We shouldn't let bureaucrats or central planners make that decision. We should let the economy do it. I think they're far better. In terms of the patriotic assimilation arguments, a lot is bandied about the Americanization movement in the 19-teens and 1920s, but there is surprisingly little evidence to support any of the notions that assimilation increased after that point. In fact, recent work by Rand Abramitsky, as well as trend line support by Jacob Vigdor, shows that the pace of assimilation in terms of economics, family size, religion, political party support, all this stuff, basically didn't. It's an uninterrupted trend. The naturalization movement, the Americanization movement, did not have any of those types of effects. Chaim wrote a great book on it called Strangers in the Land, which had large portions about the Americanization movement. And he has a whole chapter in there about immigrants who were actually really turned off by the idea of a bunch of angry nationalists telling them that they need to be more American and they're un-American. So there's a lot of quotes, for instance, by Polish immigrants who came here to flee Prussianism. They came here to flee a militaristic society. And then they are very turned off by hearing basically the same ideas being spoken back to them. So you could make an argument. We don't have the data to really say it, but you could make the argument that in some individual cases it might have actually slowed down the pace of a patriotic assimilation. But all these comparisons between immigrants themselves and third, fourth, fifth, and sixth generation Americans are kind of silly. We can't just compare the immigrants themselves. We have to compare their kids and their grandkids over time, and we need to compare the cohort to the cohort. We can't compare today's immigrants to sixth-generation Americans. We have to compare today's second-generation immigrants to the second-generation immigrants from 100 years ago. We need to see, is there a difference in terms of their assimilation, in terms of their identity? We heard a bunch of disturbing poll research from the late 20th and early 21st century. We didn't hear anything from the system 100 years ago in terms of polling data. We had some nice quotes by Woodrow Wilson, but I don't really think quotes by Woodrow Wilson are worth very much in terms of measuring the pace of assimilation into the United States over time. Again, I think a lot of my opponents exaggerate the effect that elites have and public schooling has in the United States. The bad thing about public schooling is that they teach our kids nonsense. The good thing is that our kids aren't learning anything. So it's also true that when you do a lot of these polls where you ask about Hispanics in the United States by generation, how are you doing, how are you assimilating, what those polls are generally do not capture the number of people who are the descendants of immigrants but who do not self-identify as Hispanic. So if you were to ask me in a poll, I have Middle Eastern grandparents, do you self-identify as a Middle Easterner? What do you think about it? I've never self-identified as that in a poll or otherwise. You're basically, by definition, having a poll that is skewed toward those people in the third generation who are the least assimilated, who are the people who identify as Hispanic, not the people who intermarry and who do not identify as Hispanic. I think there's also some very fuzzy stuff going on. If you take a look at immigrant support for Republicans and basically equate that to support for limited government, I don't think I'm the only one who remembers 2001 to 2007. So let's not make that mistake going forward. What we actually want to take a look at is the policies, both on a state level and the federal level, and what happens to those policies over time. Can you even draw a correlation to the idea that immigrants support bigger welfare or bigger policies and see an actual effect? No, you can't see an effect. You actually see the opposite effect. When immigration was closed off, you saw a massive growth in government not long afterwards and continuing until about the time that it was reopened. So you have a lot to explain if your goal is that. Now, as a Californian who escaped serfdom, apparently, from California to make it out to Virginia, you take a look at California political history. It was never conservative. In California, they've always had a large welfare state in California. They've always had gun restrictions. As part of their anti-immigrant policies from the late 19th century, they've had more gun restrictions than almost any state in the United States. And thanks to Governor Ronald Reagan supporting other gun restrictions, my folks who live there have a very hard time owning firearms, while in Virginia, there's no registration for me. The notion that California was suddenly about face changed due to immigration is not true. I think you can build a very convincing argument, however, that it was changed by the GOP committing political suicide in 1994 by blaming immigrants for all the problems in the state, which, of course, was not true if you take a look at the data, but also has a wonderful effect of turning people off to a political party, especially when it's a growing demographic. I don't think it's very difficult for a political party to gain long-term, at least this is my reading, Michael Barone will probably correct me, it seems very difficult for them to build broad long-term support by being pro-immigration, but it seems very easy for them to hurt themselves quite a bit by being very opposed to immigration. And I think I saw that one of the many things that occurred in California about the pause of immigration in 1920s, jump-starting assimilation, there's no evidence of that. The evidence of the trend lines continued. So that's sort of the equivalent of conservative political correctness. I don't really see any evidence for it anywhere in terms of that. And I guess I'll end on the skills of current immigrants right now. It's true that immigrants today are far less skilled on average than the average American. They're about as skilled as the average American was in 1965 in terms of that. So they're not a bunch of illiterate the chances of them having not a high school degree is similar to Americans in 1965, which isn't all that bad in terms of that level. So the notion that the government should be able to plan which workers will come here, what our economy demands, I think is absurd. I think we have too rosy a view of the American past when it comes to assimilation. I think it worked well in the past. The trends are that it's working well right now in the future. and I will let Mark tell me why he thinks I'm wrong.
Good. Thank you, Alex. I will. But I just want to touch on a few points here. First, I want to sort of underline Andy's critique of George's idea that we can't deport all 12 million illegal aliens. We're never going to have a line of buses 3,000 miles long or whatever it is. I mean, that's just sort of silly rhetorical devices. What we can do, what do you do when your bathtub is overflowing? You turn the tap off before you start mopping up the floor. The first thing we need to do is put in place the enforcement systems that are necessary to limit future illegal immigration. We need to have universal use of the E-Verify system. So when you hire somebody, a new person, you do all the paperwork anyway for Social Security and IRS, that you verify that they're not lying to you. This is something that's not required now. We put in place visa tracking. If you come, we have a pretty good check-in system for foreign visitors, at least at airports. We don't have a very good check-out system, and we don't have really much of. We don't even have a good check-in system at land borders. And if you don't know who leaves,
Mark,
then
how feasible is that technologically in your view?
At airports, it's actually very easy to do. At land borders, it's becoming easier to do with facial recognition and what have you. It's not, I mean, it's, you know, it's not the moonshot. Let me put it that way. It's not something we're going to be doing tomorrow, the land border entry-exit tracking, but it is, in fact, doable. But my point here is that you turn off the tap and arrest all illegal immigrants who get arrested and deport them, because we actually have a system called Secure Communities. Some people thought that ordinary people would thought we've always had this, but it only was fully implemented last year, where when you're arrested, your fingerprints are scanned, and they go to the FBI. This has been going on for a long time. The FBI sees if there's a warrant out for your arrest in a different state, that sort of thing. Well, only last year did we fully implement the system where those fingerprints also go to Homeland Security to see if you're an illegal immigrant, have been deported before, what have you. And that's what President Obama just a couple weeks ago announced the discontinuation of. He's pulling the plug on what I would describe as sort of one of the most kind of elementary immigration enforcement measures. What that would do is lead to significant attrition. I don't know how many, but maybe 1, 2, 3 million fewer illegal immigrants. And then once all of that's working and in place and overcomes the courtroom jihad that will be launched against it by the alliance, the sort of axis of the ACLU, the Chamber of Commerce, and the AFL-CIO, then you can, in fact, and I'm, in fact, in favor of amnestying a lot of the people who are still here. I thought Michael's insight that these flows sort of start and can start and stop in unexpected ways, no, but unpredictable ways, is, in fact, an important insight. I mean, we require certain humility, I think. It requires certain humility in thinking about this. And this idea of central planning, of sort of planning the immigration flows is, in fact, absurd. We cannot really game the immigration flows effectively. George was talking about the idiotic provisions in the Gang of Eight bill that set out to the penny over a period of several years how much an immigrant sorter would make as opposed to something else. I mean, it's just ridiculous. This is why what you need is simple, neutral yardsticks. Things like if you're the husband, wife, or minor child of a U.S. citizen, you get to come in. If you're not, you don't. There's no central planning. There's no sort of bureaucrats gaming anything. I mean, there'll be a lot of immigrants gaming it, lying about who they are and all that, but that's the way it is with any program. But even with regard to the skilled or employment-based, I think employment-based immigration shouldn't exist. Skills-based immigration is different. In other words, you set a bar somehow. I would set it much higher maybe than others, and then you just let everybody in, and they make their own way in the labor market. If they, you know, if you let in somebody with 140 IQ score, and he ends up, you know, making guitars on a commune in Vermont, well, it's the way it is. You know, the point is you let in some smart people, and then they just sort of do whatever they're going to do. The question there is, where do you set the bar? The other point on relating to Michael's point about the unpredictability of these flows, I would actually disagree to some degree that the
1920s immigration cutoffs had no effect, because what you do see with mass flows, whether it's not just blacks, but blacks and whites from the South moving to the industrial cities of the North, people moving to California from the South, or, you know, immigrants moving into the United States, is that they can become a kind of, there can be a kind of herd mentality. In other words, there can be a kind of, hysteria really isn't the word, but it can kind of take a momentum, a life of its own. Law, changes in the law can in fact stop that, can interrupt those sort of social processes in a way that changing the law, that not implementing the law wouldn't have had. So my point is that law can in fact have a significant effect, I think, on these admittedly unpredictable flows. And the other point about the unpredictability of these flows is that we can't predict where the next one's going to come from, but we can be pretty sure that given the 5 billion people in the world who are poorer than the average Mexican, that they're going to come from somewhere. I don't know whether the next large-scale flow of low-skilled immigrants is going to come from Haiti or Congo or Albania or Kerala State in South India, but I can be pretty sure it's going to come from somewhere. And this is why we have to continue to have in place a tight immigration system. And the I briefly just wanted to touch on this idea of skilled immigration. I wrote a piece recently in National Review Online titled, I think, something the effect of skilled immigration isn't all it's cracked up to be. And there are two claims that people often make in arguing for more skilled immigration. One is that it's economically beneficial. The other is that they're more likely to assimilate. And both of those are true to a degree, but there's nuance to it. Just on the economic parts, yes, there's no question that you let in a lot of college graduates, they're much less likely to be on welfare, although they're way more likely to be on welfare than American college graduates. But putting that aside, it still has similar effects. Borjas actually, in his book Heaven's Door, looked at this issue, and he estimated that if you took in 1 million college graduates a year, in other words, immigration of today, which is 1 million a year, were completely made up of college graduates, you would end up reducing the wages after a decade and a half of native college graduates by 15%. And in the long run, what's probably more insidious and harmful is that by reducing the returns to college education, you would see a 15 to 30% drop in native college enrollment. Now, that 15 to 30% drop is not all going to be coming from people majoring in basket weaving, because the people, you know, that people were talking about taking in are supposedly people in tech fields and what have you. And that's where a significant reduction and atrophying of our ability to create homegrown talent in technical and scientific fields actually is a serious both economic and national security problem. And my last point I want to bring up is something that was kind of implicit before, but Alex made it explicit now, was that he's saying it's okay to have open immigration lead to lots, you know, unlimited immigration, because that's what we're talking about here. It's not necessarily open borders, it's numerically unlimited immigration. That it's okay to have that in combination with a very tough and demanding means of becoming a citizen. In other words, you let in lots of people, but very few of them can become Americans. And I would submit that that kind of Saudi Arabian immigration policy is fundamentally contrary to the idea of Republican government, that the only reason we should be even permitting immigration is with the goal, not necessarily the requirement, but with the goal that everyone who moves here to live among us permanently is at some point, after a certain time of preparation, intended to become one of us. That immigrants will marry America and not just shack up with her. And the idea of replicating what the United Arab Emirates and Saudi Arabia and Qatar and Bahrain have, which is a small population of citizens ruling over a large population of foreigners, is fundamentally contrary to the American idea.
We don't have a huge amount of time left, but I'd like to see if anyone else on the panel would like to say a few words, and then we can take a few questions. So, John? Andy?
No, I'm good.
Questions, comments? Yes, sir. Oh, yes, wait for the mic.
Peter Jesser Smith of the National Catholic Register. One of the things that I'm looking at is, well, first of all, I'd like to say that part of my family comes from 1610, and the other part comes from the 1840s Irish escaping the famine, and we still have our parades here to show how we're still here. And everybody joins us, so I guess we won. Look, the question that I have really here is, Alex and I, in about 35 years, are going to deal with a world that a lot of people in here aren't. And it's a world that is going to be fundamentally different from the ones that my grandparents had, where there was 40-to-1 workers supporting each retiree. We're going to be dealing with 2 workers for every 1 retiree. And the question is, how is a small government going to be possible with the type of restrictive immigration that we're looking at? Because what the other economists and demographers are telling us is that government, the taxes are going to go up, there's going to be a huge amount of burdens, and a lot of the solutions to making sure that we don't have immigrants seem to massively involve government expansion and the power of the police state. How is this going to lead to a more stable country when we can't replace our own birth rate? It's at 1.8 now. Just for the long term, can you address this?
I always thought it's kind of interesting when supporters of limited government say that immigrants are going to beef up the size of the state, therefore we need to beat them to it and beef up the size of the state to stop them from doing it, and basically hurt ourselves in the process by a national ID card, e-verify, or any sort of other such scheme which doesn't really achieve the goals that even they want to achieve. Fundamentally, the entitlement systems are bankrupt. By any normal accounting standards, generally accepted accounting principles, they're presently bankrupt. The cash flows are so negative that it's somewhat terrifying what's going to happen. The only question is, when are they going to get reformed, and how catastrophic will the bankruptcy be, and how able are we to recover from it? Every actuarial study of Social Security that estimates an increase in immigration, even lower skilled immigration, assumes that it puts off that day of reckoning a little bit. Does the same thing for Medicare right now. Medicare Part A is supposed to go bankrupt in 2024, which is optimistic. So it'll probably be sooner than that. So immigrants currently pay more into the system. That's not a fix to it, but it is a way to hold off that one day of reckoning for it. In terms of future population growth, I would like to know, I'm trained as an economist, I would like to know the economic model that says fewer people or fewer workers is good for the economy and good for growth. The fact of the matter is, if we do have the immigration policies, some of the more restrictive ones that have been proposed up here, we will see a shrinking U.S. population in the future, and I know that's not good for it. So
we actually have no idea what's going to happen to the population in the future, because demographic projections beyond 20 or 30 years are meaningless. And if immigration were zero tomorrow, zero, which I'm not sure anybody's for, I'm not, our population will continue to grow. The projections are it'll continue to grow for generations. So the idea that we are somehow in the same position as, say, Russia or Italy or South Korea is, first of all, is incorrect. Native-born Americans simply have higher fertility than native-born people in
It's been lower since the recession. Couple of years, we don't know.
Yeah, exactly. We don't know what's going to happen.
And a lot of that growth is on the elderly side.
But the point here, I think, the broader point is that every country in the world is going through a demographic transition like this, with drops in fertility. Iran's total fertility rate, the number of babies these fictional average woman at any one time will have during her lifetime, the total fertility rate in Iran is lower than the United States. In China, it's lower than in the United States. In Tunisia, it's lower than in the United States. Every place except Yemen, Chad, and Afghanistan, I think, and maybe Niger, are seeing dramatic drops in fertility. So the idea that we're going to somehow fix this as though it's a problem, fix this by importing people from other countries where fertility is also dropping, is missing the point. The fact is, this is a fundamental aspect of human development. When this is part of our evolution as human beings.
Well, Mark, we don't know. There have been a few instances, have there not, of countries in Europe rebounding at least a little in their birth rates.
Sure, there's going to be. There's going to be some rebounding.
We don't know that human beings may not respond to the policy problems that he's talking about by, among other things, higher birth rates. Those things have happened, notably the baby boom of the 1940s and 50s.
Which was delayed fertility, really, rather than increased
fertility. Well, I don't think that's right, but we can argue that otherwise.
But, Mike, the overall point that fertility at, seven children per woman coming down to two children per woman is going to be reversed is simply not – it's never going to happen.
Well, we're not
going
to have –
That is never going to happen.
Well, actually –
We're talking about tenths of a point.
He's making an argument for free immigration for Mormons.
Yeah, well, there you go. Let me finish my point here. Because the premise here – there's also a kind of – there's the premise here is that Americans are somehow defective or broken, and that we need to import better people who are less defective than Americans, because Americans aren't having the right number of kids that elites think they should be having. Well, I think American moms and dads should be deciding how many Americans there are going to be in the future. And if we have anti-natalist policies, we do in fact have tax policies and others that discourage people from having the number of kids they would want to have, we should be getting rid of those. But the idea that the way we fix America is by importing people who are better than us because they make better decisions about how many kids they have is offensive to me.
They're better to us in one respect, which is that they're younger.
No, but that's not that's not
the
point.
If you're talking about younger women, they're more likely to have a baby when they're 25 than when they're 60, okay?
Yeah, but that's not the point. The point is not admitting younger immigrants. The point is admitting people who have higher fertility than Americans. That's the argument. Americans get to have whatever fertility they want. It's not the state's business to decide that your fertility as an American, that our fertility isn't high enough, and so we're going to change government policy in order to increase it.
But it's the state's business to be involved in the movement of people across borders.
Absolutely.
To affect that change in other areas. Just because I think there should be free trade in oil doesn't mean I think American oil is defective. Just because I think that there should be free movement across border doesn't mean that the people here are defective. This is the best and most productive country in the world with some of the best institutions. People want to join these institutions. They are essential to human flourishing and human freedom. And the point about demographics, there is a well-known U-shaped curve. There is not some a destiny where we're going to have lower birth rates forever. There's a U-shaped curve. Past a certain point in development of income, people start to have kids as status symbols. It's sort of an income effect rather than a substitution effect. And we see that at the end of lowest low fertility in European countries amongst the natives, not amongst the immigrants, an increase in fertility over time as their incomes reach a certain point. So it's complicated. I don't think the central planning government could be able to figure it out. I don't think we should trust it.
Mitt Romney couldn't get away with voluntary deportation, I don't know what we're going to do with Americans that are defective.
We have time for one more question.
Yes, sir. For
he's the defective one.
Wait for the microphone.
32
grand. Mark Naterno from the Interactivity Foundation. I think that it's obviously the case, as you pointed out, that a lot of people may want to move into a country without becoming a citizen of that country. And at the same time, I'm really kind of struck by Mark's, the metaphor. You want people to marry America rather than simply shacking up with her. And I'd like to hear some sort of an extrapolation about the differences, because I think we all know the differences between marrying a woman and shacking up with her, about the differences between marrying a country and shacking up with her. What are those differences? What are the consequences of merely shacking up with or?
Okay, go ahead.
This is where I think my concept of patriotic assimilation plays a role. Take as a hypothetical, say a Korean American student, a girl, in the seventh grade when she studies American history. Does she think of this as, well, that was my history? She thinks that when she thinks when she studies about Washington and Hamilton and Jefferson and Madison, does she think of those founding fathers as my ancestors, even though I came from Korea and they're not directly my ancestors? I've adopted them because I've adopted the story of America and the good and the bad. I've adopted the Civil War and the Revolution and the internment, let's say, of Japanese and World War II and everything else. I've adopted that as my story, so I've patriotically assimilated. And I think that's what Alex said. We don't have any data. It's true, we don't have data on how well assimilation worked, but I think we have plenty of anecdotal evidence that Americanization did help. I think every family probably in this room went through Ellis Island has a story of that. And the new data shows that this this type of deep patriotic assimilation is not occurring today. Whether it occurred in the past, we think it did. We don't have data to prove it, but it's not occurring today. And it's not occurring because, as we almost all of us at this table have discussed, that's not what American schools are teaching. They're not teaching this Korean girl in the eighth grade that Washington and Hamilton and Jefferson were your ancestors, just like anybody else says they were mine. My parents coming from Italy, we adopted them. So that and Sidney Hook writes about this in his autobiography. So that's the type of patriotic assimilation we should be promoting, and that's the difference.
I agree with John about patriotic assimilation. I'm not troubled by people coming here, behaving legally, but not becoming citizens. Their children, under prevailing interpretations of the 14th Amendment, are entitled to citizenship if they're born in the United States. And then the question about assimilation comes in, where I think we're deficient these days. But, you know, I go back to George Washington's letter to the Truro Synagogue in 1791. People want to come here, comport with our laws, and live under their own vine and fig tree. We welcome them as equals, but I don't think there's an implication from that you have to take out citizenship. I think you have to behave like a good resident, at least. You know, we don't necessarily want them. And if you're troubled, as Mark may be, by the idea of dual loyalties, if there's some ambiguity about that in the resident's mind, maybe you might not want him to take up citizenship if he's ambivalent about it.
Well, I'd like to thank the Hudson Institute and the panelists, Alex and Mark, for this stimulating morning. It's the start of a conversation. I hope you all will stick around to continue it. Thank you very much.